Can I welcome you to the 15th meeting in 2015 of the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee. Everyone present is reminded to switch off mobile phones as they affect the broadcasting system. As meeting papers are provided in digital format, you may see tablets being used during the meeting. No apologies have been received for this meeting. At Agenda Item 1, the committee will decide whether to take Agenda Item 6, consideration of evidence for access to Scotland's major urban railway stations in private. Are members agreed? Thank you. At Agenda Item 2, the committee will take oral evidence from the Cabinet Secretary on public procurement reform. Can I welcome Keith Brown, Cabinet Secretary for Infrastructure, Investment and Cities, Paul McNulty, Deputy Director of the Procurement Policy Division, Iain Moore, Head of Procurement Policy Branch, and Mark Richards, Solicitor at the Scottish Government. And can I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make an opening statement?
Thank you very much, Convener, and thanks for the invitation to come along to the committee today to provide an update on the proposals that we have for implementing changes to procurement legislation in Scotland. I'll try to outline the progress that I believe that we've made so far, as well as our current position and our plans for implementing these changes, which, as I'm sure the committee are aware, we must do by April 2016 in order to comply with the deadline set out by the EU procurement directives. The committee will also be aware that the past few years have seen a period of significant improvement in public procurement in Scotland through the reform agenda. And members of the committee, or some members of the committee, will be familiar with much of the background, having been involved in the development of the Procurement Reform Scotland Act 2014, which builds on that improvement. It also establishes a national legislative framework for sustainable public procurement that supports Scotland's economic growth through improved procurement practice, and the Act, as you'll know, received royal assent on the 17th of June last year. Since then, work on the development of regulations and statutory guidance arising from the Act is being taken forward in conjunction with the work that's been undertaken to transpose three new European procurement directives into Scots law. And those directives cover public sector procurement, utility sector procurement, and the award of concession contracts. The changes taken together are complex and the timetable is a challenging one, so in order to be as cohesive and as consistent as possible, we are taking the changes forward as a suite of activity, and our intention is to make the changes as simple and as easy to follow as we can for all of our stakeholders and the procurement community alike, and also to avoid where possible one set of rules applying to large value contracts and a different set of rules applying to contracts of a lower value. We believe that would be unhelpful to both public bodies and the business community. I mentioned that we must complete the transposition process by 18th of April 2016, but it's our aim to try and do so before then. And it's our intention to lay the regulations before the Scottish Parliament before the end of this year. We've received a number of requests from the procurement community and further beyond for us to allow a reasonable period of time between the laying of regulations and their coming into force. That would allow time for public bodies to make the necessary changes to their internal processes and procedures, and that's something we'll have to look at quite carefully. Some of the changes introduced by the new directives are mandatory. They also have some elements where the Scottish Government has a choice about whether or not to, or how best to implement further change. And those discretionary elements and the Scottish Government's plans to implement these were the main focus of a public consultation which we recently held and which closed on the 30th of April. So we hope to be in a position to publish the final consultation analysis within the coming weeks, and we intend to use its findings to inform the policy decisions we need to take as we develop the content of the new regulations. Unfortunately, I'm not yet in a position to provide the committee with a copy of the analysis report itself, but what I can say is that for those elements of the consultation where the Scottish Government set out its view on how we should best give effect to new legislation in Scotland, respondents seem for the most part to have agreed with our proposed way forward. So the consultation may be over, but that's not the end of our engagement with stakeholders. You'll also be aware we are required under the Act to produce statutory guidance on a number of issues. So we've been speaking to stakeholders about the content already, and we'll continue to do so as we develop the content of that guidance. And I'll repeat what I've said previously in the Chamber, that in respect of the statutory guidance that addresses workforce-related matters, such as the living wage, we are looking to introduce that in the autumn. And alongside that guidance, we'll need to commence a number of other provisions for technical reasons. We may also take the opportunity to commence some fairly straightforward and hopefully non-controversial provisions, such as the prohibition on charging companies to participate in a tender exercise. The changes introduced by the directives and the Act represent a significant opportunity to make procurement easier and administratively less burdensome. And as a major consumer in the economy, spending around £10 billion annually, the public sector can, through its procurement policy, exert significant influence to help support economic growth. We ourselves can play a key role to promote jobs and growth, to encourage innovation, to boost training and apprenticeship opportunities, and to help Scottish firms, particularly SMEs and third sector organisations, compete effectively for contracts. So I'd welcome the opportunity to engage with the committee at this stage. It hopefully provides the committee with the opportunity to understand our current position. Our intention is to keep you informed by written updates as we progress. So thank you for your attention and happy to try and answer any questions.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. I'm going to hand over to Alec Johnson, who's going to open this session.
Thank you very much. Could I begin by asking, does the government have an overall view on the reform package that's come out of Europe? Do you see it as a good thing or is it just a hindrance?
No, I think we think it is a good thing. I mean, it really starts from the philosophy of trying to make it as straightforward as possible for companies to bid for contracts. And I think we would certainly share that aim. It takes away a lot of the previous provisions which were there before, and I think it's also generally consistent with what we've been trying to do in the Act as well. So obviously whilst we can fine-tune it and we can take some decisions, some of which are discretionary as to how public bodies go about their business in Scotland, I think it's largely consistent with what we've been trying to do.
Does it fit well with the Scottish model of procurement and will there be specific problems in some areas in implementing it here?
Well, I think that depends on how we go about the process of transposition just now, but I think largely it does fit well. And I think it, obviously we have some issues. The living wage issue has been played out a number of times in the Chamber and in public debate, where perhaps we'd like to have been able to go further than current EU law allows us, procurement law included. So I think there are things where there are some tensions. That's perhaps inevitable dealing with 28 different countries. So, but I think we can address most of those through both the Act that we have and now the guidance that we're about to publish and, of course, the way in which we transpose them. So I think we're going with the grain of what Europe's trying to do here.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned the living wage issue there. Would you see that as a specific conflict between what this piece of regulation is trying to do and what the government's long-term objective might be?
No, what I was trying to point out was I think we would have liked a position where we would have had the backing of European law, including European procurement law, to be able to insist upon the living wage being paid in contracts. We don't have that. I think it's acknowledged now. Every public body, some were said to have been providing the living wage or making it a condition of the award of contracts. When you actually examine all the examples which have been given, a number of local authorities and other bodies, that's not the case. And I think everyone acknowledges that you are subject to challenge if you try to insist on payment of the living wage as a condition of the contract. There are other ways, I think, to try and achieve that aim, which is the way that we've been trying to work. So we'll make the best of that legislation to try and achieve the aim of which is our ambition to see everybody paid a living wage, and certainly through public procurement to try and achieve that. But so that was, if not a conflict, perhaps European law and procurement law doesn't allow us to go as far as we'd like to in that particular area, but we'll try and achieve that by other means.
I'm just trying to see into the future and see if we may have any difficulties. Are there any other areas where these reforms, EU reforms, might bring government policy into conflict with EU objectives?
Well, I think our intention is to try and avoid that by the action that we take now. So, you know, some of the things we've just consulted on, some of which are discretionary, they are discretionary because the European procurement body of law allows us to make them discretionary. And it's possible that, obviously, public bodies could end up on the wrong side of that if they don't exercise that in the correct way. But as a general principle, no, we're obliged to comply with European law, and that's what we'll intend to do.
Just one final question. Why did the government wait a year to publish its consultation while other areas, including the UK government, have already introduced new rules?
Well, I think we took a different approach from the UK government. We wanted to consult because of the fact that we'd just gone through the Procurement Reform Act here ourselves. But also, if you look at what the UK government did, they, for example, copied out legislation, just reproduced what was given to them by Europe in some cases. We have decided not to go down that particular route. And we also wanted to take our time to consider the implications of the Act and also the statutory guidance. So I remember when I first got this job back in October last year, I met with the Welsh Finance Minister, who talked a lot of this, and she had a very high regard, wasn't down to me because it wasn't, it was in post previously, but she had a very high regard for the way the Scottish Government had used procurement law for other means as a tool to achieve other things, and they've tried to reflect that in their own legislation. And she compared it with, for example, the UK procurement, which is procurement in her view. I think I don't want to misrepresent her views, I'm sure she can speak for herself, but the point she was trying to make was that we have used procurement law, in her view, I think, quite imaginatively to achieve other ambitions, whereas elsewhere in the UK they perhaps have just been fairly straightforward in terms of how they use procurement law. And that's perhaps reflected in the fact that the UK government just merely copied out much of the legislation that came from Europe rather than doing as we've done. And I think it's right to consult and take people with you.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to move on. Who's next? Adam.
Morning, Cabinet Secretary. Could I ask what the timescale is for the introduction of the new Scottish regulations and their implementation?
Certainly. We are required to give effect to the three directives, which I mentioned earlier on, by the 18th of April next year at the latest. So our intention is to introduce legislation in Parliament by the end of this year, and we're aware that some people already have asked that once laid there should be a gap, as I said in my opening statement, between the regulations coming into effect, or the regulations being laid and then coming into effect, and that was really to give bodies, public bodies and others, the time to change their internal procedures, and we'll consider that proposal further, but we are obliged to transpose the, or give effect to the three directives by April next year.
Okay, thank you. Could I ask what level of response there's been to the government's consultation, and are you able at this stage to give a broad overview of some of the emerging themes?
I've mentioned, I think, one or two of those already, but we are still analysing. There are 140 responses, I think 133 from organisations, 7 from individuals. There has been broad consensus in some areas, perhaps as we'd expected, so there's agreement to the position advocated by the government on how to best implement the new legislation. On the statutory guidance, respondents have asked, not surprisingly, because these are features of the European and I think the Scottish legislation, they've asked for consistency, proportionality and transparency. There was agreement that there should be consistency of rules irrespective of the contract value. Of course, there's discretion with smaller contracts to take a different approach. And also there was agreement, by and large, that public bodies should have as much discretion as possible to allow decisions to be taken in procurement exercises that they believe are relevant and proportionate to their individual circumstances which apply at that time, rather than to have it too prescriptive. So I suppose those are the broad themes that we can identify already from the responses, but as I say, detailed analysis is still ongoing.
And in terms of what happens post-consultation, does that mean that you'll be tweaking, the intention would be to tweak the regulations according to the responses that you get?
Certainly. I mean, that was obviously the point of our having the consultation. And it's basically because a number of the areas in which we've consulted on leave the Scottish Government with some discretion. And I think it's right that we talk to public bodies. Some of the public bodies, of course, are local authorities. They have their own mandate. They're democratically accountable. And I think we want to take that into account. So, yes, it was always our intention that, although we have been able to identify broad themes in the responses so far, that the statutory guidance and the regulations that we lay should be informed by the views. Sometimes we might not agree, but as I say, so far we can identify some large areas of broad agreement, and that will inform what we do. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. James, you have some questions.
Vienna, good morning, Cabinet Secretary. To what extent do the EU reforms simplify the procurement rules for business and for public bodies?
Well, as I mentioned previously, I think that was the intent behind the EU legislation. But until we see how the rules operate in a practical context, it's a bit uncertain as to how absolutely sure we can be about that. I mean, one thing to say is, having taken away a fair bit of the architecture that was there before, I suppose it could have two potential effects. One is it could free up and make it much easier for companies to apply for contracts and so on. Another way of seeing it is it could open up areas of doubt, so it may hinder people's... It's like the old thing that used to say in Scotland, I'm sure it never happens anymore, but in local government, where somebody was making a planning application, and it could be often be the case, in the absence of definitive guidance from the planning authority, they had to kind of put it in and hope and see what happened. Now, some people like that because it left them freedom of action. Others would like to have had a bit more certainty or guidance as they were going forward. So I suppose there's always two sides to it. But by and large, I think we've come down to the view that we want to make it as open as possible, take away as much bureaucracy as possible. But as I've said, I don't think we'll be able to see exactly what the effect of that until we've moved forward. The Commission and the Member States set out with that goal of modernising and simplifying the procurement regime as a means of fostering economic growth. I think whether it's the fact of the recession or other reasons, they've looked at the procurement architecture which they had. I think we've all seen over the years different problems in terms of procurement, challenges which have been made, and been driven by the fact that we're in a period of recession, is my view. They could speak for themselves. They've tried to make sure that we do what we can to foster economic growth. So I think that's what's driven taking a lot of the, as I say, architecture out. And one of the key changes is that we can allow non-central public bodies a free hand to decide how they run certain types of competition. I think that, I think it's no secret that's been welcomed by many bodies so far. The only legal obligations that we'll have will be to publish on certain contracts a prior information notice, and that has to demonstrate that they're going to run the competition in accordance with the treaty principles, and then at the end of the process to publish an award notice. So very light, if you like, stipulations, and that's a pretty radical departure from the existing regime, which, as I've said, lays out pretty detailed rules which govern both the detail of the process and the timescales that have to be adhered to. So there's a clear expectation that this change will simplify the rules for both businesses and public bodies, although, as I've said, there is a risk that it might not achieve that objective in practice, and that's because allowing that degree of flexibility in the process might make it more difficult for businesses to understand the processes which public bodies apply. I know that sounds a wee bit odd, but I think the planning analogy is a good one. It's also true very often of the Commission in the past. Sometimes governments and other bodies took action not certain as to what the Commission's response would be, and if you asked them in advance to give you that comfort about what you were doing, you often got, I think, an equivocal or no response, and you had to take the action and wait to find out whether it was going to be challenged. So they are trying to strike, I think rightly, that balance between making it as easy as possible but as giving as much guidance so people act in the correct way.
Earlier on, you talked about simplicity and simplifying things. In the document, the government state that it does not intend to mandate that larger contracts should be broken into lots. This is a proposal intended to help SMEs. Can the government explain why it does not intend to do this? Surely it can't be just down to simplicity.
Well, I think one of the key themes which have emerged from the consultation which we've had, and I think we expected to see this, was that types of procurement activity that public bodies are involved in are so varied that applying a one-size-fits-all approach is rarely appropriate. And we think it is important that public bodies do retain that flexibility to structure contracts according to their individual circumstances. Apart from anything else, I think public bodies will often know what the marketplace is like in their own area and might want to tailor their procurement processes towards that. And it's in that context where you have to remember that the Procurement Reform Act places a clear duty already on public bodies to consider how, when they plan their contract, they can facilitate access for SMEs, third sector and supported businesses. And we believe that in that context, the duty should help ensure that where a larger contract can be broken down into lots without disadvantaging the authority, then it will be. And I think it's also worth saying that we've got a pretty good track record on this already in Scotland in terms of supporting SMEs. We're one of only three EU countries where the SME share of the public procurement market exceeds the SME share of the economy. So I think we I've got a track record of supporting SMEs. I think that's taken some time. I do remember in the early years of PFI and PPP that a lot of smaller companies felt they could not act apart from the costs of bidding. The size of the contracts were such that they had to rule themselves out and then were really consigned to being only ever subcontractors and very much at the mercy of the main contractor. I think we've changed things quite substantially since that time, say 10, 15 years ago. So I think we've got a good track record, and that is the way the culture is just now in Scotland, and that's why we've taken the approach that we have.
So you're comfortable enough that the safeguards that are in place will protect the SMEs from being squeezed out of the process?
The safeguards, and also I think the culture. I mean, I think both central government, local authorities and other bodies now are sufficiently well aware of the benefits of having a vibrant SME economy, and that itself I think will drive the change further. As I say, we've already achieved a great deal in the top three of EU countries, but I think that will safeguard the position of SMEs.
Okay, thank you. I've got one last question. Are there any resource implications for either businesses or public bodies in implementing the new rules?
Well, there will be for the Scottish Government, there's no doubt about that. There are no obligations which are placed upon businesses under the new legislation. All the obligations which are brought in really rest on the public bodies in terms of how they conduct their activities. So if, as I've said, the overall new regime is designed to bring in simplification and modernisation, then there should be overall benefits for businesses rather than new obligations. I think during the first phase, say the first 6 to 18 months, then there are going to be obligations on public bodies to get themselves up to speed. And I mentioned the representations that we'd received from bodies to try and give them a bit of time to implement the legislation and the regulations. And that will obviously involve a cost. You know, public bodies will have to change the processes in order to do that. But we are seeking to mitigate those costs by developing, amongst other things, training materials. And are also working with the Cabinet Office at UK level to take advantage of material that they've already produced, including e-learning packages. So the intention is, and it would have to be the case if you've got both European procurement law moving this way and the Scottish Procurement Act, to try and make it easier and lighter. The last thing you want to do is to make it a burdensome process to get to that. So we're working very hard on that.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Mary, you have some questions.
Thank you. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Morning. There are a wide range of social and environmental factors that can now be taken into account in public procurement. Which of these do you think will bring the biggest change in procurement, and what will the benefits be?
I think part of it will have to be a question of, as things go forward and how it's applied by different public bodies, will let us know that in due course. But you're right, there are a number of different benefits. Eco labels are one thing that's been mentioned. You can take these things into account. They're a kind of shorthand way of knowing that bodies bidding for contracts have come up to a certain standard in terms of environmental practice. There are social factors, as I think you've mentioned, which I think will be tangible and measurable. They are there already. We've done, I think, tremendously well in recent years in terms of professional and apprenticeship opportunities through community benefit clauses. But in our view, the changes which will have the greatest impact are the new sustainable procurement duty, and that includes the requirement for bodies above a certain level, I think it's £5 million, of procurement activity to produce a procurement strategy, and the requirement to report annually the performance against that strategy. That's quite a discipline on public bodies. Every year they're going to have to account for what they've done. And I think also putting that strategy out there just makes it much more easy, going back to the previous point I've made, that making it as easy as possible can also create a vacuum. And one way that you can help that process is to put your strategy out there. So a public body puts its strategy out there. All those that are considered in dealing with that public body, apart from being able to use, for example, the PCS, the portal for public contracts, they will know what that body's trying to achieve. We're looking to do some, I think, innovative things in terms of workforce practice and so on as well. But we, like everyone else, will have to put that out there so everybody knows the ground rules. And I think that will produce the biggest benefits.
And how will you monitor that going forward? Will it be a review process? And is it possible that you may change the guidelines around what factors are taken into account and what sustainability should be done?
The review process, of course, will be forced upon you because you have to report each year annually on that strategy. But obviously, you don't go into making regulations with the the idea of very quickly changing them. We wouldn't want to do that. But of course, you have to be open to the fact that times change. I mean, we're quite different, the environment we're in now from, say, 5 years ago, just in terms of the economic cycle. And of course, I think there's been a really fast pace of change. I mean, I've been involved in, whether through councils or government now, for 25 years. 27 years, actually. A long time, and it's changed dramatically in that period. You know, when I first came into local government, there was a huge degree of discretion that local authorities could use, you know, sometimes not going out to tender at all for things. So things have changed and things will continue to change. And in that circumstance, of course, you want to have the ability to revisit these things. But we're hopeful that this will be a sustainable procurement set of regulations that we won't have to change them too soon.
Okay. And in relation to supported businesses, how do you think the reforms will work in practice? Where you have contracts can be reserved to sheltered workshops where 30% of employees are disadvantaged. And I have to say, it's not a term I'm particularly comfortable with using, but the word disadvantage has not been defined in the EU directive. So what interpretation are you going to put on it?
Well, I think we'll arrive at a conclusion of that after we've had a look at the consultation responses in more detail. But you're absolutely right. It's a very vague term that they've put on it, which you can either see as being a problem or an opportunity. You could see it as any class of employees who might have a harder time getting into the job market than others, whether it's through gender, race, disability, or even other things, geographical access. So it does give you that level of discretion. I think what you'd want to do is try and apply the rules or the ethos, which is about proportionality and relevance. So the changes in the rule book will have, in effect, it will substantially broaden the categories of business that can be regarded as supported, and does that in two ways. One is by broadening the categories in the way that you've mentioned to include all disadvantaged, and secondly, it's the reduction in the percentage of employees that fall within the classification from 50% to 30%. Most of the supported businesses I've seen are probably closer to 100% actually, the supported businesses, but there will be some, or this might even provide the idea for somebody to take up the opportunity to start looking at, for example, employing people with a disability up to, say, 30% of the workforce, and then allowing them to become a supported business in that way. So it is, you're right, a factor that they have not defined disadvantage. We haven't defined it either, and I think we will wait to see exactly what the analysis and the responses is before we come to a conclusion. But I think we'd want to try and see it as an opportunity.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary will probably recall that there was some discussion during the course of the bill going through Parliament about the level of prescription with regards to support for supported businesses. If you recall, there was discussion over the number of contracts public bodies should award to supported businesses, and perhaps there was also value of contract. So my question really is how this will be monitored in practice, as it were, for each public body to report on the level of support they provide or the number of contracts that they award to supported businesses. And on the back of that, if there is a monitoring regime going in, is there a possibility that these regulations could be reviewed or revisited depending on the performance of public bodies in supporting supported businesses?
Thanks for that. I think the main thing to say is that, as I mentioned, bodies above or procuring above a certain level of £5 million will be required to have their strategy publicly issued, and they can have as part of that strategy, of course, that element of it. So that would be a way to achieve it. And I think what you've seen, not least through the Parliament, is quite a number of events I'm aware of. I was less aware of the early developments of the Procurement Reform Act being involved in a different area of government, so you tend to get a bit focused on the area that you're involved in. But I think we've all been to a number of events here in the Parliament where supported employment has been at the centre of it. So the annual procurement reports, which I mentioned, which the contracting authority is required to prepare or revise, and it's important that maybe that goes to the second part of your question, that they can revise their procurement strategy. in relation to financial year must provide an annual procurement report on its regulated procurement activities, and it has to include a number of things, including a summary of the community benefit requirements, but also a summary of any steps taken to facilitate the involvement of supported businesses in regulated procurements during the year. So they're going to have to report on this in any event, and I think that in itself will help drive change, and that's an annual thing on which they'll have to report as well.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. And just one very brief final question. How will the reforms on use of labels like fair trade work in practice, and what benefits do you see that the reform bringing?
I think the labels themselves have to carry credibility, but I think they can be a very useful way to avoid a substantial tick box exercises that companies will have to go through. If they can, it's a kind of shorthand, I think, and it's not, as far as I'm aware, and perhaps Paul or other officials could mention this, it's not prescriptive. There are some which will be obviously understood, in, whether it's fair trade or equal labels. You could see, for example, I would imagine a development of a fair work label, which would, I suppose to some extent, that's what the business pledge that we're trying to encourage people to sign up to is. It's a kind of shorthand way of saying that this company adheres to certain standards in terms of fair work. But I don't know if one of the officials wants to comment.
There are provisions in the new EU directives on labels. But they come with a number of preconditions, and one of which is that the label, if you like, must be relevant to the characteristics of what you're actually buying. Now, that presents certain challenges when you get into issues like fair work or fair trade, because quite often the schemes relate not to the characteristics of what you buy, but actually the kind of circumstances in which they're produced. So I think, you know, we're looking at this carefully. We will see what guidance we can issue when the new rules come in, and we'll do whatever we can to promote fair trade. But I don't think that the changes in the new rules are a kind of panacea that will all of a sudden say that you can specify fair trade labels without having to go through some of the hoops that the existing legal framework require you to go through.
So do the preconditions overcomplicate things and make things more challenging?
In a way, arguably, they merely clarify what the existing legal position is on the back of a European case that involved a Dutch authority that sought to buy fair trade coffee. And what that case said is that, you know, you can specify the characteristics, if you like, of what you require, but you can't focus in on a particular labelling scheme in isolation. You have to leave it open to other participants to be able to demonstrate that they would meet the same criteria. What the new directives do is go a little bit further and say that you can actually refer to labels, but those labels have to be relevant to the characteristics of what you're buying. And that presents a challenge when you're looking at labelling schemes that deal with the way that a producer is rewarded, if you like.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. What approach does the government tend to take in the options for exclusion of businesses on the grounds of tax evasion?
I think the first thing to say is that the approach that you have to take is legally defensible. I think that's quite important. So the options that we have in relation to that, I think, would fall into two categories. Firstly, whether or not that we want to, through the regulations and so on, make particular discretionary grounds upon which you could exclude a business from a tendering exercise, you could make it mandatory for public bodies to do that. And secondly, whether or not to replicate the same rules that the directive makes for higher value contracts, make those rules also apply to lower value regulated contracts. So the proposals that we set out in the consultation paper were broadly those grounds for exclusion, I think you mentioned tax evasion, which are at the discretion of public bodies should remain so, because those making those mandatory for other bodies would place them at significant risk of legal challenge, both from those companies which claim to be wrongfully excluded and those who claim competitors have been wrongly included. You know, one company arguing another should have been excluded. So, and I think there's also that question of proportionality. In addition, we also propose that the same rules should generally apply to lower value regulated procurement exercises as well as to higher value exercises. That was largely for reasons of consistency and for ensuring there's a proper transparent process. The response to the consultation, as I said, the analysis has not been completed, but it was overwhelmingly supportive of our proposals. Trade unions, interestingly, of course, are of the view that those businesses which transgress in any way should not be allowed to win public contracts at all. Non-payment of tax, however, non-payment of tax where it's not been bolstered by a legal process, where a company's not been found legally to have not paid tax, is a key example for the trade unions. Firms that are in bankruptcy or insolvency proceedings, that's also been raised. An area of focus. 71% of our respondents agreed with our proposal that public bodies should still have discretion over whether or not to exclude such firms. And I think that's partly a reflection of the fact that we can all know from our own constituency examples of where a company might be in that situation and you want to try and safeguard the jobs that are there. So allowing discretion for the local bodies is important. So that's, we haven't finally decided on this, but that's the thinking in the process so far.
Could I perhaps give a practical example? I'm talking about a Scottish Government contract. Let's take, for example, the ferry contract next year, which you know I've got particular interest in. When you're carrying out the tender exercise, how do you ensure that the firms who are tendering, there's no skeletons in their cupboard? For example, that there's been tax avoidance within the EU, which has gone through a legal process. There's been tax avoidance out with the EU, that's gone through a legal process. There has been breaches of health and safety, where a worker may have died or be injured. All these factors can be proved because it's gone through a legal process. And even the Scottish Government doesn't have perfect knowledge. Sometimes it's very difficult to determine what's happened to a firm. But how secure can you be, particularly for high-value contracts, that there isn't skeletons and cupboards for potential bidders?
Well, it's a good question, and I think you've already identified the fact there's a tension between trying to find out everything you possibly can about a company and trying to have a process which is open to companies and you can actually get through. There's a substantial amount of diligence done already in terms of financial and other statements which companies, including those which have bid for the or are bidding for the ferry contracts, have to go through, and that will be bolstered by this legislation and the regulations that we intend to have. But you're right, you can't have perfect knowledge. I think there is a good example, without being too specific about it, another ferry contract that recently happened where, in fact, another rail contract that recently happened where the company, one of the companies concerned, had been debarred by the UK government from bidding for public contracts, and then shortly beforehand was undebarred, if you like, from bidding for those contracts. And certainly from the Scottish Government's position, we felt fairly safe that if the UK Government said that this company cannot bid for public contracts, we could say, no, you can't bid. When that was lifted, it's very hard for either the Scottish Government or another body to say, no, you cannot bid. And you are open, the contracting authority is open to legal processes and potentially claims of compensation for disbarring. So you're right, you can't have perfect knowledge. But I think even before we go through these processes in terms of regulations, we've got pretty stringent processes for making sure that that's the case.
You've probably rightly predicted that was the example I was just going to give. If you're going through a procurement process and your officials have been looking at checking the background of the company and they get a clean bill of health, and then subsequently you find that there has been a problem, such as tax evasion in the EU, have you the ability to pull them from the bidding process once that tender process has started?
Well, I'll ask the officials to come on this, but we already have, because of the rules we have around, say, for example, blacklisting, the ability of any contracting authority that finds out, for example, a company with blacklisting to just take the contract away from them. You already have that ability, but I don't know if the officials want to come in the back of that.
It's standard practice to make it a condition of participation that you actually tell the truth as a company. And if you find out subsequently that they haven't told the truth, then there are certain steps that can be taken. I have to say, it hasn't happened in my experience. The blacklisting issue that the Cabinet Secretary mentioned, the guidance that we issued to public bodies in 2013 recommends that they include a clause in the contracts that specifically says that in the event that you are found guilty of an offence connected with blacklisting, that would be the 2010 UK government regulations, then the contract can be terminated. So, you know, there are things that can be done if you find out that someone hasn't told the truth, and it's standard practice, certainly for our larger value contracts, to issue pretty dire warnings to companies of what the consequences will be if they don't tell the truth during the process.
I noticed as well, again, taking the new ferry contract for next year, and there is a break clause introduced in these contracts so that if you do subsequently find there's problems, that you can pull that contract halfway through the term.
Quite often there will be break clauses in contracts, yeah. Perhaps on the general issue of perfect knowledge, when the concept of mandatory exclusion was introduced just over 10 years ago at a European level, at that point in time, the European Commission had on the table a proposal to create a pan-European database of relevant offences, but I think that just died a death given the complexity that the Commission was finding with that project.
I won't extend the debate, Camille, because I know time gets on, but certainly I remember having meetings, in fact, I think it was with this previous committee when we met the European Commissioner talking about contracts. What was quite interesting from the Commission's point of view was this idea, well, that's all fine and well, as the Commissioner was saying, but this is a state issue. It's really up for you as the Member State to carry out these obligations. I think as a general rule, sometimes we are far too dependent on getting legal advice handed down. My experience of these things is there's a halfway house, and many other European countries, frankly, take the ball and run. When it's not totally clear, and as the lawyer here will testify, the law's not always totally clear when it comes to EU. Mm-hmm. I sometimes think we're a little bit introverted when it comes to going ahead with what we feel is right and not necessarily getting our hand held by the Commission, but that's perhaps another argument for another day. Could I perhaps just ask then about blacklisting, since the Cabinet Secretary mentioned it? Does the new regulations from Europe give us more clout to ban firms that have been blacklisting?
Well, I think the directives give us that opportunity to do that. But just going back to your latter point, I think you're right to say that sometimes you can act in a... It's possible to be too inhibited by what the EU might do. It's also true to say that applies to the UK government. If they decide to take a different approach, they are the state. And if we take the wrong approach, they don't like it, then we have to have regard to that as well. So, and these are not matters without consequence. You can have a contract having to be run that can cost you several millions of pounds, the disruption to individuals. So I think you're right to say that, not to be too inhibited and sometimes to stretch these things as much as you can. In relation to blacklisting, though, as you asked, there are no substantive changes in the new directives, but we are taking the opportunity in drafting the regulations to make it very explicit that breaches of employment law, over which, of course, we do not have control, but that includes the 2010 blacklisting regulations, which have been mentioned, are to be regarded as grounds for exclusion. In addition, we've also given the STUC a commitment, I've given it to them myself, that we'll work with them and other interested trade unions to agree what that guidance should say. And as I've mentioned, we expect to publish that guidance in the autumn.
And notwithstanding, and I agree with your point about the Member State, notwithstanding that issue, if there's a potential conflict with the Scottish Government of whatever political complexion is a disagreement with the UK Government, surely that's an issue to be raised by the Joint Ministerial Task Force Europe. I mean, that's what it's set up to deal with. I mean, if you had experience personally of being on that task force and making the case for a different view from Scotland from the UK Government.
Well, the Joint Committee, I've been on the committee before, but there are, it's usually, of course, External Affairs Ministers which are involved in that. Actually, that probably wouldn't always be the best route through which to try and make sure there was no legal dubiety. I don't think, incidentally, it's necessarily the case the two parties, there has to be two different parties at UK and Scottish level to find a disagreement. certainly not in the early period, 1989-2007, when I was involved quite a lot in the European side of things, there was disagreements then. I think it's trying to make sure, just as I was saying before, that you can try and eliminate uncertainty, because uncertainty will inhibit people's actions. So if you can make it as certain as possible without being prescriptive, that's got to be the best outcome. And yes, of course, but not necessarily through the Joint Committee on Europe. We will have discussions with the UK Government on these things.
My final question, Alec Johnson's touched on this already. That's the whole issue about living wage. I mean, does the new procurement reforms help dictate contracts that give a bit more clout that there should be living wage? And I know there's been some advice received from Europe. So, for example, putting into a contract, the expectation is that the winning bidder will pay the living wage. I mean, there is, as you know, legal form of words which can still comply with directives on this.
Yes, but I think that the point to be made is that you cannot stipulate, you cannot make it a condition of the contract that a bidder pays the living wage. Now, you all know as well as I do, and I'm glad to have the opportunity to say this, in the Chamber it's often been alleged, for example, the government and my party voted against having the living wage. It's not possible to do it. And other places which have said that they have done it, including a number of boroughs in London and I think other local authorities, it's been proven that's not the case. They've now come forward explicitly and said they recognise that you must act in a way that's compliant with European law. So I think we've moved on to that ground where we know we can't do it. And what we're now looking at is which provisions allow us to try and achieve that without stipulating it. And there are a number of different things. So the workplace reforms, the workplace things that you can take into account, some more general things you can take into account about economic benefits of awarding a contract in a particular way. It's got to be relevant, it's got to be proportionate, but if we can say people being paid a living wage makes that contract more sustainable, then we can achieve that, as we've managed to do within the Scottish Government. We can actually achieve that aim through a different process.
Yeah, so for example, in a competitive dialogue type of negotiation for tenders, as you had for, I think, the Northern Isles, is it not possible to make it clear to everyone bidding the expectation of Scottish Government is the winning bid will pay a living wage?
On which contract, sorry?
If you take the Northern Isles contract, which I think was a competitive dialogue method of discussion.
Only in as far as you cannot be in a position of making it too clear to them that really their bid depends upon them making a commitment to pay the living wage, because that way you're acting in a way that's going to get you into a breach. They can take action against you. If you were to, for example, not give them a contract because they didn't give you that commitment, they can take action through the European processes. So it's how you can use other methods to achieve that. And if you can make a case for saying that it makes the contract more sustainable, it's got to be proportionate. Perhaps the officials would want to come in this, but...
What we've actually done is published guidance issued last year that basically says that you should take account not just of the living wage, but of a bidder's general approach to how it treats its workforce. Mm-hmm. We think that's important because... You could be a living wage paying company and still not be a particularly good employer because of other terms and conditions that apply to your workforce. So we're strongly recommending that wherever it's relevant to the quality of service that's delivered under the contract, that public bodies actually take account of workforce matters in general. Mm. And within that, we piloted this approach on our catering contract, and all five shortlisted bidders came forward with a bid that said, we will give you a commitment to pay a living wage. So, you know, it does seem to have the desired effect where it's applied.
I take Mr. McNulty's point that just because you pay a living wage doesn't make you the best employer in the world. My experience, for what it's worth, the trade union movement is that's unlikely. Ruckman-like employees don't tend to pay the living wage and then be very poor in other areas, but I bow down to a different view of the world than perhaps...
Our guidance actually says that payment of the living wage, we regard that as a key indicator of whether or not you're a good employer. It's just not the only indicator.
If I just come to the last point that Dave Stewart makes, it is the case, even very recently, that a public authority has tried to ensure that the living wage is paid, has achieved that, and then subsequent changes, for example, cutting of hours for the employees or other conditions of service, has happened. And it's always difficult to say whether it's happened as a result of the company paying a living wage. So I think the approach which you've taken in the Scottish Government, the contract that was mentioned, is designed to try and stop that happening. So it is possible, even if you're not a Rachman-like employer, it's possible to accept that you're paying a living wage and then denude the conditions of service for employees. And just one last example, I mean, the cleaning contract was mentioned. The biggest contract we let is the rail contract. We managed through that to get not just all directly employed individuals, but also every subcontracted individual, including cleaning, catering staff, to be paid the living wage. And the other thing just to say is, of course, if you get the living wage paid, the real benefit for those companies is that, by and large, people who have been paid the living wage need to spend all the money they've got, and they will spend it in the economy. And that increases discretionary spend within the economy, which is beneficial to companies and the economy generally.
I agree with that. I think the jargon is virtuous circle.
A good run, David.
Thank you, Convener.
Can I just, on that question of the living wage, the Scottish Government's made it clear, as a government, that it's committed to paying the living wage to its own employees. And if I have understood you correctly this morning, you said that you would have liked to have made it a stipulation of contracts, when awarding contracts, that contractors pay the living wage, but the European Union legislation prohibits you from doing that. Am I right so far?
Are pretty clear that we would be challenged on it, or susceptible to challenge at a European level if we made it mandatory.
Do you happen to know the officials explored the issue of whether the member state, which I accept isn't Scotland in this case, would the member state or any member state be able to seek a derogation on something like this?
It's a good question. I don't know if the officials know.
Secretary, yes, we've had those discussions with the Cabinet Office of the lead UK policy department on public procurement, and they share our view of the legal position. We've also had discussions with the European Commission about the issue, and what is clear is that those member states that have tried to make payment of wages which exceed the local minimum wage set by statutes have found themselves in the European Court of Justice. There are three cases to date and another one in the pipeline that we expect a judgment on this year. And all of the judgments have gone against.
That's clear. Would you be able to share that information with the committee?
Certainly.
Just to inform our understanding of the issue? Can I just ask you, though, would it be possible for the UK as a member state to seek a derogation from the legislation?
No. The reason it's not possible to seek a derogation is that the fundamental issue, despite some of the cases having involved the Posted Workers Directive, which could be repealed by the Commission if they had the will to do it, not that that will exists, so far as I'm aware. But the fundamental issue here is the treaty. So you would actually have to reopen and rewrite the treaty in order to get over the kind of European obstacle.
So why was it possible for the UK to have derogations on other issues, such as the social chapter, but not on this issue?
Because the obstacle here is the fundamental treaty principles of free movement of services and free movement of workers. I would happily write to the committee on this if that would.
Derogations tend to be won and lost at the point the treaty is agreed. So the Danish have had derogations, but they've got that one. But I think the more important point, perhaps, convener, is that the UK government could right now make an obligation that living wage is paid simply by making sure the national minimum wage is a living wage.
Right.
Okay. So they could do that. Or if we had the power over the national minimum wage, we could raise that to a point of being a living wage.
If I could just add, I mean, that's exactly the point here, and one of the reasons the Commission tends to view this whole issue as an issue for Member States is there would be absolutely nothing to stop the UK government, if it wished, actually setting a national minimum wage that reflected local, regional, devolved administration priorities around what they wish to pay. And the UK government is entirely free to set whatever level of national minimum wage it likes without infringing EU law. The EU law position is that having set a minimum wage in statute, you can't then actually set a higher hurdle for participation in public contracts.
Okay, thank you for that. I'm going to move on. Mike, you have the final questions.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary.
Morning.
As you know, I'm a firm advocate of using technology to boost our efficiency and productivity. So I wonder if you could describe the government's approach to implementing the requirements on e-procurement and what work needs to be done by public bodies and businesses to ensure that Scotland's ready for the implementation, I think, in 2018.
Well, I think we are well placed because of the actions that have been taken so far. I think the Parliament's a very good example of an e-environment, if you'd like to call it that. So I think the things that we've done up to now mean that we're well placed, but there are new obligations. So some of the examples we already have is there's a comprehensive suite of e-commerce tools, including an e-ordering system, which is in use by around 100 public bodies currently, and which currently processes around £5 billion worth of transactions every year. And the e-commerce systems, for the most part, are operated as national shared services, and they're centrally funded by the Scottish Government. While the financial memorandum of the Act, as you mentioned, identified the need for further investment in Scotland in some staff to support the development of those systems, as I say, we are satisfied that we're at a pretty advanced stage in terms of that development and in terms of being at an advanced stage of readiness for the implementation of the new Act. So we welcome it. I think it goes with the grain of what we've been doing for a number of years, and we don't foresee any problems in us implementing the Act.
Thank you. And my final question, are there any other particularly novel or significant aspects of the new procurement directive or any other directives on utilities or concessions that the Cabinet that you would wish to highlight to the committee?
Well, maybe see if the officials had anything to add, but the one that's different, I suppose, for the because it came from the UK government, is this idea of mutuals, for example. So social enterprises, where the UK government, through its Big Society initiative, has sought to move some public services or allow public services, facilitate them to be delivered by social enterprises. We don't have that view, so we don't intend to push in that direction. And I think our guidance that we eventually issue will reflect that. But that's a fairly novel thing. I'm just trying to think of anything else. That provision that I've mentioned is limited to circumstances where, for example, the social enterprise, which is bidding for the public works, has not had a similar contract from the public body in a previous three-year period. As I say, it was negotiated by the UK government in order to facilitate its broader policies, but we don't share that policy objective. Although, you know, as a possibility in some limited circumstances, it could be of use. I think the UK government have also excluded health services from that provision as well. That's the one that stands out to me. I don't know if the officials have got anything to add to that at all.
I think one of the other ones that's probably worth drawing the committee's attention to is the obligations in relation to enforcement and monitoring of procurement activity. The new European directives place an obligation that an organisation in Scotland should monitor how procurement rules are being followed and will have to publish the results of any monitoring on a three-yearly basis, and it will look at things like confirmation, which is often done incorrectly or causes legal uncertainty. Also talk about the level of SME involvement and information on preventing, detecting and reporting on procurement fraud. So one of the options that we asked in the consultation paper was what sort of body should that responsibility fall to? And the suggestion which seems to come back at the moment is that the government's single point of inquiry, which currently resides within the procurement directorate and is a place for both suppliers and buyers to seek advice where there are concerns about procurement rules, should be an option that should be considered as taking on this responsibility. And in addition to the monitoring, one of the other elements that we have to consider is we will need to ensure that the new directives have some form of remedy applicable within them. Now, currently, the remedy process in Scotland is an application to the court, and it's court action. And again, we were seeking views from stakeholders as to whether or not that would be the appropriate to take forward in the new directives, or whether there should be some sort of alternative or something sitting alongside or perhaps below an action into the court, such as a tribunal or an ombudsman. So those are our options, again, which we are considering as we look at the analysis.
Thank you.
Are there any final questions from members? Okay, in that case, Cabinet Secretary, can I ask you to give a commitment to the committee that you will keep us updated on the outcome of the Scottish Government's consultation on changes to public procurement rules in Scotland, and to do that prior to the publication of the regulations?
Okay, to do it prior to, we'll certainly, I said that I think when I'm opening statement, we do that, we keep the committee up to date, so certainly happy to undertake to give that commitment.
Okay, thank you very much. Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary and our witnesses for their evidence this morning, and I'll now suspend this session briefly for a changeover of witnesses. Resume our session. Good morning. At agenda item 3, the committee will now take oral evidence from the Cabinet Secretary on Glasgow Prestwick Airport. While Keith Brown, Cabinet Secretary for Infrastructure, Investment and Cities, is remaining with us, can I welcome Mike Baxter, Director for Finance and Analytical Services, and John Nicholls, Director, Aviation, Maritime, Freight and Canals at Transport Scotland and the Scottish Government. Can I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a brief opening statement?
Thanks, Convener, and thanks for the opportunity to update the committee on the recent progress at Glasgow Prestwick Airport. I think you last received an update on the 12th of November, and since then a number of changes have been made to create what we believe is the right structure to take the business forward so that it can be returned in due course to the private sector. Members may recall that we appointed Andrew Miller, formerly of Air New Zealand, in November 2014, as non-executive chairman of both the holding company for Prestwick and the operational company. And more recently, in the last two or three weeks, we've appointed four non-executive directors to help take the business forward. And these non-executive directors were selected because each one of them had a particular set of skills and a track record in the key areas identified by ourselves and others to help take Prestwick forward, including communications, property, engineering and marketing. On the passenger side of the business, members are aware that Ryanair has increased its overall presence in Scotland, operating out of three airports rather than two, which is good news, of course, for Scotland, but it has meant a reduction in the number of Ryanair passengers travelling through Glasgow Prestwick. Projected passenger numbers for 2015-16 are 782,500 compared to 1.58 million last year. And the team at the airport are working hard to try to secure growth in passenger numbers with other airlines, both scheduled and charter. On the cargo side, projected tonnage for 2015 is 11,678, which represents a 3.4% increase compared to last year. In relation to financial support, which I know the committee were interested in, £6.3 million was loaned in 2014-15. That loan was less than we originally earmarked because the company achieved additional income from wind farm mitigation from the Bristol's lease and on a slower development of some capital expenditure. £10 million loan funding has been allocated in the current year, and of that £10 million, £2 million has been drawn down so far. We've always been very clear that Glasgow Prestwick is not a typical airport, and it will rely on the development of a wide range of business opportunities to make it successful. And since the last update, progress has been made in some of these areas. I think we've also always acknowledged, certainly the former Deputy First Minister, now First Minister, has always said this is a process that will take some time. The Prestwick Board have decided to establish its own fixed base operation to handle business jets, military aircraft and the like. And that's a decision seen as being better commercially for Prestwick. That was a significant change as the service was already being carried out by two companies and it was necessary to end their lease at Prestwick. And since that change, Prestwick has seen a significant improvement in both aircraft movements and revenues, which are up 74% compared to last year. The airport has attracted other new businesses. I mentioned Bristol's helicopters, constructing a new hangar for their search and rescue operations, and of course the Trump organisation basing aircraft at Prestwick. Finally, convener, members will be aware that Prestwick is on the shortlist to become the UK's first spaceport. Indeed, John Scott secured a debate in the chamber where he and others highlighted the potential Prestwick offers in that regard. And the airport has put in place a bid team headed up by Stuart McIntyre, who I've met and discussed this with, and who to me is very impressive. That team is working closely with the local authority, with South Ayrshire Council, the aerospace businesses around the airport, and the space industry worldwide to put them in a good position to develop a robust and compelling bid. Members, though, will also be aware that the owners of Campbelltown Airfield are considering a bid as well. While it remains the case that more than one Scottish side is in the running, the government, of course, will remain neutral. But as I said in the debate which John Scott held, I think Prestwick is in a strong position, particularly given the amount of effort, care and thought that they're putting into the process. So, convener, we remain of the view that it will take time to turn the business around. It was on a trajectory before we stepped in to take it over, but we believe that can be done and that both Prestwick and the business around it can thrive in future. Thank you.
Very much, Cabinet Secretary. Mary Fee is going to kick off her questions.
Thank you, Convener. I wanted to explore a bit more the issue around loan funding, because you gave us a very brief update in your opening remarks on loan funding. Would it be possible for you to give us a figure of projected loan requirements for the airport?
Well, I think what we do is we put in place facilities for a certain amount of loan. I'll talk a bit more about that in a second. But it really has been at the discretion of the business as to how and when they draw down that facility. So we previously announced that £25 million in loan funding was available. All that funding, incidentally, requires to be repaid, and we require to make a return on that investment. So £4.5 million was loaned in 2013-14, and that was the first year of the government's ownership. £6.3 million, as I mentioned, was loaned in 2014-15, which was less than the £10 million allocated. And it just underlines the point I was trying to make, is that although we can put in place these facilities and we go through a process of diligence before we do that, it really is up to the company as to when and how much of that facility they draw down. And during that year, last year, the airport achieved, as I mentioned, additional revenue from commercial activity. And the £3.7 million remaining has therefore been carried forward into 2015-16. So the 15-16 provision has been made for £10 million plus that £3.7 million carried forward. And as I said, around £2 million of that has been drawn down so far. We've made no commitments beyond this year, but we'll be keeping the situation under review. And I'm happy again to update the committee as and when we reach conclusions on what further loan funding might be made available.
Okay. The £25 million you mentioned, is that the maximum amount of loan funding the government is prepared to commit to Prestwick Airport?
No, we've taken a judgment based on what we think is necessary and also what the discussions that we have with the airport have taken forward. I think if we were to go any further than that, then it would be on the basis that we intend that the monies would be repaid. And that obviously involves a calculation that the airport has a future trajectory which will allow it to repay that money. So that's the basis on which current loans have been made. It would be the basis on which any further loan funding will be made. But as I've said, the loan funding that we've made available already, I think if you go to the airport, you'll see the improvements that that's managed to achieve. But as I say, the rate of that will depend on the airport's own decisions, and any future funding will depend on a discussion between the airport and ourselves.
Mm. Audit Scotland recently estimated that loan funding of £39.6 million would need to be made available to Prestwick up to 2021-22. Is that a figure that you disagree with?
I'm not sure that's exactly what Audit Scotland said, but I don't know if you want to come in.
Happy to comment. 39.6 was the projection that Audit Scotland had reported. I think the point that the Cabinet Secretary has made is that we will need to continue to monitor position, because the profile of that drawdown is up until 2021. So as the situation develops over the intervening period, we'll keep that under review. I think it's important to say also that we're not simply reviewing a one-year position, that we are continually reviewing the long-term business plan with the airport and have a presence on the board at the airport.
Okay,
thank you. I just mention one of the points on that. Obviously, Audit Scotland made their own calculation about what the necessity was, and also made some comment about passenger numbers, which you might come on to. But there are other things at play here. For example, in relation to air passenger duty, that could change both the requirements for revenue and for passenger numbers. So I think we're happy to take it in the stage way that we are just now.
Okay. Can I move on then to talk about passenger numbers? Because, I mean, it is a very challenging situation for Prestwick Airport. In a way, it's good news for Ryanair because they're expanding into other airports, but that has a significant impact on Prestwick. And the drop in passenger numbers is around 360,000. So what discussions have you had or will you be having with Ryanair to try and look to build passenger numbers into Prestwick?
Well, those discussions would necessarily have to take place between the airport directly and Ryanair, and those discussions have been taking place both before, after and during the decisions which Ryanair have taken. Ryanair have said that they remain committed to Prestwick, and they've got substantial operations aside from the passenger traffic that they have there. And also Ryanair, as I'm sure you're aware, is changing its kind of business model in any event, so there are new opportunities there. So I know that the management at the airport have been very assiduous at looking for new passenger business. They're working very hard on that, and I would hope that they would be able to come forward with positive progress in relation to that. But that, those are pretty commercially sensitive discussions which they need to have with both Ryanair and other potential users of their service. But I think the other point, which I know has been made before, is that there's quite a number of different facets to Prestwick. It's quite an unusual airport in that sense, the fixed-based operations and so on, the maintenance and the freight of a different character to other airports. So it wouldn't just be on that. But the discussions, as you've asked, they will be taking place between Ryanair and the airport.
Okay. And can I come on now to ask about freight? Because freight has decreased at Prestwick Airport, although it has started to slightly pick up again. Between 2003 and 2013, freight tonnage fell from 40,000 to 10,000. But I note from your opening remarks that it has started to pick up. How significant to the future of Prestwick is freight?
Well, you're asking me quite rightly, and I think I'd have to give my impression of that. I haven't had a discussion with the board. I think it can be very substantially significant, and the reason for that is because I think Prestwick's got a very good reputation within the industry and the way it turns around freight. It does so very efficiently, and it's got a growing reputation for that. And I mean, there are some other challenges because of some other flights which have come in, and the tendency these days to put freight into the belly of aircraft which are carrying passengers. You're right to say that there's been an increase, I mean a 3.4% increase between 2014 and 2015, getting towards the 12,000 tonnes. I had a bit of a discussion with them. I think one of the things is that they will want to increase their intelligence as to where opportunities for new freight are. Sometimes the information they get can be a bit ad hoc, you know, say from truck drivers in the area who will tell them about different businesses that are freight carriers that they're involved in. So I think they'll want to improve their intelligence as to what the opportunities are. But this, I think, is an area where the reputation that they've already got, both increasingly with the military as well, but domestically, I think presents a real opportunity for them. And perhaps we're seeing that in the change, the 3.4% increase that they've had.
And of course, the Cabinet Secretary will know committee's just recently finished an inquiry into freight, and one of the things we looked at was air freight. So it may be possible with the recommendations from our inquiry that Prestwick may benefit in some way from all of that work.
Well, I would hope, and I don't know if it's the case, that the board at the airport and the senior officers have had a look at that, but if not, we'll certainly make sure that they get a copy of the committee's recommendations.
Yeah, but it's still its draft. Right. Can I just finally ask you about the railway station? Because the last time we had an update on Prestwick in November 2014, we were told that the railway station is an important part of the picture, as it's one of the biggest selling points for the airport, but it does need substantial capital investment. So has any capital investment been earmarked for the railway station? And if not, why not?
Well, again, I have to say that's got to be a decision for the airport themselves. Now, you're right to say anybody going past the airport can see it's in need of at least refurbishment. It's unique in the way that the ownership falls to the airport, obviously. What I have done is made sure that, from my point of view, that the airport is well aware of the different funds which are available from the rail franchise. So the £30 million stations investment fund is there. However, they would have to make a case for that. But I have to say that it's quite right that the airport themselves look at what their capital investment priorities are. They might not be able to do everything they want to do at once. So if they want to come forward and also be an applicant for the Rail Stations Improvement Fund, then they can do that. But it's got to be them that take that decision, and it's got to be based on what they think the capital priorities. So the work that's been done into the reception areas, the retail opportunities there, they may have seen that as a bigger priority at that stage. I've mentioned what loan funding we've made available, possible other sources of finance, but they have to take that decision.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
James.
You know, I've just got one question for you, Cabinet Secretary. It's about the four non-executive directors you mentioned that have just been put in place. Are these the final senior appointments to be made? And if so, are you satisfied that suitable governance arrangements are now in place to return the airport to profitability?
I think yes to each of those questions. It's that that series of appointments completes the board structure for the airport. I spoke to each of the appointees before I appointed them and or agreed to their appointments, and yes, I think they've got a breadth of experience there, particularly in relation to marketing, which is very important for the airport, but also in relation to governance, and I think that breadth of experience is something that will I'm very hopeful will really sort of help the airport move on to the next stage of its development. One of the directors has got a tremendous experience in the south of England in the ports, moving from a situation of being a public authority to a private, back into the private sector. And I think there's, having spoken to each of the non-executive directors, there is a real breadth of experience here. But that does complete for this stage. Obviously, vacancies can arise, but that completes the board appointments at this stage.
Okay, we'll watch it with interest. Thank you. Jim?
Okay, moving on. Alex, you have some questions.
Thank you very much. Minister, I wanted to address some of the issues that were raised in the Audit Scotland report. And I note that the Audit Scotland report indicates that the purchase business plan identified average annual growth in passenger numbers of 10% or that order in each of the first 5 years. However, we know that passenger numbers have fallen and continue to fall at the moment. How have your officials assessed, or have your officials assessed, why these predictions were so inaccurate at the beginning of the process, and what might affect how this might affect future plans?
I don't accept that they were inaccurate. They were certainly different and much larger than the UK government's 1 to 3% forecast generally, but they were consistent with other forecasts on a wider level. And I think the Audit Scotland report also said that even at that lower level that the business case had been made for a positive decision to take take the ownership of the airport. So the figure that we provided was done by our expert advisers at the time of the purchase. As noted in the report, it was, as you've said, growth of 10.2% in the first 5 years. It was later revised, and of course we didn't pick and choose the timing of having to take over the airport. You know, that was presented to us by market conditions, so these things were done in less than ideal timescales. I think that's been acknowledged. But the senior advisor that we appointed reduced that figure to 6.5% when he was able to put together the Stage 2 business plan. And the committee, I know, drew comparisons between those figures and, as I mentioned, the DfT's aviation forecast for the whole of the UK. But I did mention earlier on that one factor that that did not take into account was the impact of APD. Now, you'll know that the government's commitment is to reduce by 50% in the next Parliament the impact of APD, with a view that public finances allow to eliminate it altogether. But Ryanair and many other people have pointed to the substantial growth that could engender if we're able to do that, because of the inhibiting factor of that, what's the highest APD in the world, I think, just now. So I don't accept these were unrealistic, although they were forecasts made based on the information available at that time. And also, it's worth saying, in comparison to the DfT stats, they have the primary purpose of passenger forecasts being made to inform long-term strategic aviation policy. And it also, the DfT's own guidance says that making any prediction about the future is inherently uncertain, and especially that's true in aviation. So the report places more weight in the role of these forecasts in informing long-term strategic policy than in providing detailed forecasts. Specifically for Prestwick, the DfT report shows potential growth to 1.8 million passengers in 2020 and to 2.6 million passengers by 2050 from the baseline in 2011 of 1.3. So you've asked about our assessment. Our assessment of passenger growth projections, I think, was reasonable at the time based on the best information available. And our forecasts of growth in passenger numbers were lower than those of many passenger aircraft manufacturers, Boeing and Airbus, amongst those, a bit higher, as I've mentioned, than DfT's. When Audit Scotland recalculated the financial return, as I've said, using that less optimistic prediction, the model still showed a positive return being achieved. So, yes, we do consult on these. We are obviously talking to the airport management themselves. I've mentioned about the efforts of the airport management to increase passenger numbers. And obviously we've seen the effect of the Ryanair decision to disperse its business across three airports in Scotland rather than two. But yes, we do continue to look at these.
The Audit Scotland report recommended that the Scottish Government develop an exit strategy which identified a timescale for privatising the airport. Has any action been taken to prepare such a strategy?
Well, we said from the very start, when we took ownership of the airport, that it was an intention to return it to the private sector at the most opportune and earliest opportunity. But we believe that there are too many variables, some of them I've just mentioned, that it wouldn't make sense for us to be specific about a date. I mentioned the passenger duty, just to go back to it again, if that changes quite dramatically the fortunes of the airport, then of course you could achieve that position much more quickly. So I don't think it makes sense, given that's just one variable. Others have mentioned, you know, the spaceport. If the spaceport bid was to prove to be successful, that could have a transformative effect on the airport. So we don't think it's sensible, given those variables, to put a specific date on it just now.
You've mentioned...
Yes, I just wondered that, you know, that might be a worthwhile juncture for the Cabinet Secretary just to remind us what the consequences would have been had the Scottish Government not taken Prestwick into public ownership.
Well, it's worth saying that if you look at the number of people directly employed and those indirectly employed, it would have had a massive effect on both the local Ayrshire economy and on the Scottish economy as well. There was nobody dissenting from the point of view that we should take the airport over. It's not something we wanted to do. We own a number of airports, but these are small airports which are vital to local communities. So we didn't want to be in the business of taking over an airport. I think over 3,000 direct and indirect jobs were put in jeopardy by the closure of the airport. So 3,000 jobs is a massive effect, and trying to replace those jobs in a place like Ayrshire would have been extremely difficult. And you know, it's quite easy subsequently to look back and say, well, maybe you should just have let it go. But if you think about some areas which have suffered massive job losses in the past, how difficult it's subsequently been to try and get that critical mass to get those jobs back. I think it was the right decision to take. And had it not been taken, then those jobs, to the extent that the people that have them were not able to find new employment, would then be being paid from public funds, substantial monies, in terms of unemployment and all the other things that brings. So I think it was the right decision to take.
Thank you.
The Minister has mentioned on more than one occasion the opportunities of the reduction or ultimate removal of air passenger duty. But I've asked this question before and I will ask it again, and that is, how can the reduction or removal of air passenger duty be a positive for Prestwick in competition with Glasgow and other airports? Is it not simply the case that it will boost air travel generally but has no specific benefit for Prestwick Airport?
Well, I think Ryanair have, I can't bring it to mind, one of the officials will know, they've been very specific, I think, about what they calculate would mean in terms of Prestwick specifically. But you're right, there's a general benefit. For example, the York Aviation study showed huge benefits. And I think, aside from those, which I'm sure we can get the details of to Alec Johnson, aside from those, people know that, we know anecdotally that countries like Mexico and other places are taking plane loads of passengers who are now going to Paris rather than London, or going to Milan or to Rome rather than London, not to mention Glasgow and Edinburgh, but especially London, because often these passengers, you know, 300 people coming in a plane to discover a new country, they're going elsewhere now because of additional costs, both of visas, which has been mentioned, but also APD. It puts you at a competitive disadvantage. And also it means that some people are leaving Scotland to go to Dublin if they want to fly to Dubai, so they can avoid the long-haul passenger duty. So I think there's no question it would benefit Prestwick. But you're right to say it's also a general benefit. I think we do have some specific figures from Ryanair and others that mention what the specific benefits would be for Prestwick, but I'd undertake to provide the member with any specific information we have on that.
On that point, convener,
as a constituency interest, who has a quick supplementary on this?
Thank you. Well, it was more a point of information. I believe Ryanair's figure was that they would put a million new passengers through Prestwick Airport if there was a reduction of air passenger duty. That's the figure as I recall it. Your officials will probably know it exactly, but certainly I would be fully in support of the reduction of APD.
John, you
That million figure, I think, relates to Scotland as a whole, but obviously that would include a proportion of passengers at Prestwick. But as the Cabinet Secretary says, we'll double check exactly what Ryanair have said and report back to the committee.
And also, we'll do some work just to help Alec Johnson out on what the general uplift that we think we would see would mean specifically for Prestwick. But I think there's no question it would be transformative for Prestwick.
I take the point, Cabinet Secretary, about the impact of air passenger duty reduction and stimulating passenger trade in Scotland. The other factor is looking at route development funding. You recall you kindly offered me a meeting about that, which I will take up once I've had some European advice. I think you recall that the government withdrew that funding, which was brought on, I think, by the Labour Lib Dem administration, I think, in the second session. And I think the problem was compliance with EU rules. As you know, I've looked at that, and currently under 1 million passengers is the sort of de minimis level. In other words, it doesn't really apply to airports under that. And I note from the figures in the brief that I think Ryanair is currently 500,000 passengers. So, I mean, I will pursue a meeting with you, and I know you can't magic a new policy overnight, but route development funding helped develop over 48 routes when it was brought in by Labour and the Lib Dems. Clearly, APD plus having a better marketing strategy, which government can help, would stimulate trade at Prestwick. Is it something you will have a look at in the longer term? And the final point is, you know, the UK government brought in the connectivity fund, and I note that the de minimis level there is actually 5 million passengers, which is, you know, 10 times more than Prestwick currently has. So I'm not convinced that Europe's the problem here. I think it's about looking at other sources of funding that help stimulate smaller airports. I appreciate we're not talking about the Glasgow and Edinburghs here. We're talking about smaller passenger throughputs.
Yeah, I mean, just to say on the route development fund, the advice we got was very clear, and that would fall foul of Europe. I think it may have happened actually before 2007. I could be wrong, but I'll check that fact out. And there's no reason why, if we were not allowed to do it, we wouldn't continue to do it. Obviously, it requires a budget commitment, but there's no reason why we wouldn't do that. And it's worth saying as well that we do help all of our airports. We have to be careful as to how we do it. So it'll often take the form of marketing and other support. But we do help our airports. And we are doing that, just to go back to an earlier question, in relation to Prestwick as well. So Prestwick will have the discussions with the airlines that they want to try and attract, but it will often involve a discussion, as it happens with Glasgow and Aberdeen and Edinburgh, as to what the government can do to help support that. So that support is still available. Your point about the numbers, the de minimis level, we'll certainly look at that and come back to you. But if there's a way to do this, we're very keen to increase, in particular, long-haul and direct flights, because it stops the more environmentally damaging, shorter flights, and it's obviously better for customers. I'm off to go on holiday soon, and I'll have to go to Gatwick to fly to where I'm going. So you can cut out those damaging journeys in between time, plus it's better for people. So we do support this, and you've seen tremendous growth at both Edinburgh, Aberdeen and Glasgow in recent terms. We've been involved in many of those things, so support hasn't stopped for the industry.
Just to make the point, if you look at the UK Connectivity Fund, I mean, that operates up to 5 million passengers per airport, so I'm no European lawyer, but how is it that the UK government has managed to get this scheme through that operates to Scottish airports who have bigger turnovers than Prestwick? I mean, if it operates effectively for the UK member state, why is it not effective for the Scottish Government? We're operating in the same rules.
Oh, can I say that? I'm happy to look at that. Maybe the officials can come and speak to that. But I know when it was announced completely out of the blue. Nobody had a clue. If you ask people at Inverness Airport, for example, nobody had a clue what the scheme was going to do or how it was going to work. Yeah. So it's taken a bit of time to achieve that. But I don't know whether the officials want to come.
I think Cabinet Secretary is absolutely right in that some of the application of the DFT scheme has been not very clear. It's something that the Prestwick management team have been pursuing with airlines, and that's what they're saying to us, is that there are there's a lack of clarity around the terms of the DFT scheme, and we'll obviously help them to pursue that. And see if we can take advantage of those particular.
Perhaps issues. The Cabinet Secretary could get back to us, Convener, on this particular point, because I do think there is a good example of the UK scheme, and I'm not convinced by the de minimis argument, but let's get a letter back from you.
Yeah, I don't think, just to say, it's necessarily a de minimis argument. We are saying it's a scheme that was introduced or announced overnight with no guidance behind it, which then had to something we worked through by airports and also civil servants. But yes, we'll come back to the later situation on that. Happy to do that.
Thank you for that. Secretary John, did you want to come in?
Just if I might be involved in that too, with particular reference to Prestwick, please.
Alex, do you have any further questions? I did have one more question. I hate to burst the bubble because it's been so optimistic in past exchanges. But the Audit Scotland report pointed out the original business case for Prestwick suggested that it wouldn't be viable without Ryanair. Is the Minister and his department still looking closely at what it would have to do if Ryanair were to withdraw completely?
I think, I'm sorry to have to repeat the point, but that calculation has to be one for the airport management. We are obliged to be at one remove from the management of the airports, but of course they look at different scenarios. However, I think they will be comforted by the fact that Ryanair have made a very positive statement about their future at Prestwick, and it is not just down to the passenger side of things. However, I know, the information I have, I know that they are not sitting on their laurels. They're working very hard to get other business to the airport. And as I've said, when Ryanair made their announcement, they made a long-term commitment to each of the three airports that they currently service. So I don't think it's an immediate threat, but I don't think either the officials want to add anything to that.
Just to agree very much with what the Cabinet Secretary has said. I mean, Ryanair, although they have reduced their operation at Prestwick, it's still 55 flights per week this summer. That is a reduction from last year. They do have the substantial maintenance, repair and operation there, employing several hundred people. And so I know that the Prestwick management team are doing all that they can to enhance Ryanair's experience at the airport and pursue the Ryanair offer of increased services when the market conditions permit. But in parallel with that, the airport team are pursuing a number of other opportunities with other airlines, which are commercially sensitive. So I'm afraid we can't say too much about those just now, but we are very conscious of the need to, or the airport management team are very conscious of the need to ensure that you know, they pursue all the business development opportunities that that Prestwick has to offer.
It's worth deciding to that on that point that one of the things they do at Prestwick is commercial airplane pilot training, and that's done for Ryanair as well as Jet2, Thomas Cook, Logan Air, Virgin Atlantic, EasyJet and others. And the other thing to say, they've had a real success this year in terms of their interaction with the military. The Joint Warrior Defence exercise, big NATO exercise, happens twice a year, and there's been a huge improvement in both aircraft movements and revenues since Prestwick Aviation Services was brought in, as I mentioned. But the Joint Warrior feedback has had, Joint Warrior exercise feedback has been excellent from the military. So I think we've got very good prospects of building that business in future, and it's quite lucrative for Prestwick. So they do have, I think the point is to make, they do have a broad base, probably broader than most other airports. The question is trying to raise it all. They don't anticipate a withdrawal from Ryanair, and they're doing what they can to make, I think as John said, Ryanair's experience as good as possible with a view to trying to expand that, but they're also looking at other airlines as well.
Adam.
Hi, thanks very much, convener. Obviously, there are commercially sensitive initiatives happening in terms of trying to increase business in the airport, but have Prestwick management managed to been able to attract any new freight or passenger services to the airport since our last update in November that you can report on?
I think the freight figures which I gave earlier on were not available at the time of the November update, that 3.4% increase. So that obviously is new business that's there. And I've mentioned some of the other new business, not necessarily freight, but in terms of the aircraft movements for the military, the search and rescue for Bristow's, and one or two other things. And in relation to passenger services, I think, as John has said, and these things for each of the airports that we work with are extremely sensitive and confidential, but I do know they're putting every effort into trying to attract new business.
Okay. All right, I appreciate that. And you touched on the training of pilots and engineers and also the maintenance, repair and overhaul work. Can I ask how this is being pursued and what success there's been in attracting new business to the airport in this area?
Well, I think I've mentioned a number of the areas. I think there's increased freight coming in from around the European continent. There's quite a substantial amount of oil-related freight that's being used as well, and I'm trying to expand that, but I don't know whether John or Michael want to say more about those things.
Operational.
In terms of additional services at the airport, as we said, there has been an uplift in freight. There has been the substantial increase in fixed base operations and also the Trump Organization aircraft, which the Cabinet Secretary mentioned. In terms of the MRO opportunities, there are a number of potential business development opportunities there, which I know the board are pursuing. Those are, as I understand it, extremely commercially sensitive at this stage, and so I don't have any further detail than that. But to say that there are things that are being looked at by the management team and very actively.
It's worth saying as well that area of business, in terms of aircraft movements and so on, the revenues are up 74% this year, and a similar gains since last year have been made both in February and in March, so it is a promising area of activity for that. Was in relation to, you know, the military activities that have been going on, the servicing or the accommodating of aircraft and so on as well. So it's a growth area for them, and you can imagine from where the Joint Warrior exercise takes place how convenient it is for the military to use Prestwick.
Just to add, Convener, the overall financial position in terms of the last year, the reductions in passenger numbers, the loss in revenue from that has been more than offset by the diversification into these other areas. So the overall turnover for the business remains pretty much on track with what we had for the within the strategic plan.
Okay, that's encouraging. Cabinet Secretary, you mentioned capital investment priorities earlier on in relation to the issue of the rail station. Could you give us an update on progress and capital investment in the airport, please?
Certainly, and I think, and I know that the member and others will be very familiar with the airport and how its condition recently, and having had a tour of the airport and its associated facilities recently, there's a lot of opportunity for capital investment there, if I can put it that way. But the board is shortly about to be asked to agree a capex for resurfacing work for sections of the runway, the taxiways and the aprons, and replacing sections of the front of terminal, the glazing at the front, and that's about £1.2 million. We have a new body scanner which became operational in April, building on the cabin baggage x-ray replacement programme that cost £500,000, and certainly when I last visited the airport, they improved quite substantially the security arrangements that are there. They're also investing in a new information centre which will consolidate car parking, car park management, lost baggage, ticketing and passenger information. There has been recladding work to the departure gates pier, which will be completed next week. That cost around £285,000. In respect of radar, a wind farm mitigation solution procurement is in progress, and that should be concluded by the end of September. And as I mentioned, that was one of the new areas of revenue, so very important that they get that right. And the airside tax-free retail area, which I mentioned earlier on, has been redeveloped and modernised, and that brings the facility up to modern standards and will provide a more attractive offering for passengers. The cost of that redevelopment was around £750,000, so a lot is being done.
You mentioned radar. There is a need to replace the primary radar system as well as the mitigating wind farms, and that's a fairly major investment that's required. Has any scheduling of that work been done so far?
Perhaps officials could answer that.
I'm afraid I'm not a radar expert, Cabinet Secretary, but what I do know is that at the last board meeting I attended at Prestwick, there was an agreement to the budget going forward, and that would have included the capital plan and all the various activities under that plan. So if it's helpful to the committee, I can go back to the airport management team and confirm what the position is on the renewal of the primary radar system and write back to the committee.
Yeah. It's not on our radar just now, but we'll get back to the information.
Okay, I'll let that pass. Operating costs of the airport. Can you give us an update on progress in reducing the operating costs, including any savings that may have been made to date?
The due diligence has showed that, undertaken at the time of the acquisition, showed that Prestwick was being run efficiently and that there was little scope for cutting operating costs. But we have, obviously, the management have sought out best value and efficiency, and the team at the airport is working with procurement colleagues in Scottish Government on both policy and a wider approach to procurement. I think one of the things post-acquisition was that the airport was able to enter into a larger utilities framework agreement, which is obviously beneficial. In terms of staff numbers, they are fluid, obviously, because of the seasonal nature of the business. The headcount has reduced as follows. So summer or May 2013, 364 staff. A year later, 361. A year later, 342. So a 6% reduction since purchase. In winter 2013, there was 325 staff. In winter 2014, 297 staff. So a reduction of 8.6%. But as I said, at the point of acquisition, our advice was there was not huge scope for reductions in operating costs. The big push is to increase the revenue coming into the airport.
On workforce matters, can I ask, is Prestwick Airport a living wage employer?
Well, as part of the pay negotiations between Prestwick and the unions, it was agreed that the implementation of the living wage would be discussed at future wage discussions, and that was a two-year deal that runs from the 1st of April to 31st of March. So it's on their agenda to do that at Prestwick.
Okay, thank you,
David.
Thank you, Secretary. We heard earlier that obviously Prestwick is one of the five bidders to host the permanent UK spaceport, which is all very exciting, and I know John Scott's had a high profile in championing Prestwick. I've always felt it's sensible to link Scotland to the moon, which I think is probably quite a good advertising slogan. Could you, thank you, could you perhaps indicate what the update on the airport's bid to host this very interesting and novel UK championship effectively?
I think, first of all, some of the promising aspects here are true of any airport which bid from Scotland. So recently I was in Canada and a company there called Comdev, which produces the satellites which go into space. In fact, it's been doing it for 45 years without one being malfunctioning. They acquired a company in Newbridge and West Lothian in Edinburgh, which produces elements of for manufacture which are important for the space industry. There was an announcement, I think, just last week about an investment in Glasgow in terms of a space company. And, of course, you have the aeronautical kind of related businesses around Prestwick, which are obviously beneficial as well. So I think, and I should say from the discussions I had with Comdev and MESL, which is a company they bought in West Lothian, they are looking at massive expansion because they have what they call constellations of satellites being put into space now. So that general background is very promising, and it's obviously why the UK government has felt it necessary to develop a spaceport in general. There are five, as you've said, shortlisted by the UK government. The others are Campbelltown, Stornoway, Newquay, and, excuse the pronunciation, Clanbar, I think it is, Clanbar. There are five on the shortlist. We don't know how many out of that five will choose to develop a bid, although we know that the operators of Stornoway have decided not to develop a bid. Prestwick, just to speak about Prestwick, they have in place a team charged with developing its bid, and we know that preparatory work is well advanced. It's working in conjunction with a range of local partners, including South Ayrshire Council, Ayrshire College, and a range of aerospace businesses to help develop a very strong bid. It's carrying out significant work to build support among the international space community. I know they've been to the States, both the East Coast and the North East, and down to Florida. We await further detail. Crucially, at this point, we're waiting further detail from the Westminster government on the technical and other criteria which will be set. And it may be the case that the five that I've mentioned reduces further once you see the technical requirements. But the timing and the process is in the hands of Westminster. Prestwick, I can say it's very well organised, and we are confident they'll be able to submit a very strong bid. But like any other aspect of the business, securing the spaceport needs to be done on a commercial basis, and it will have to have a return on any investment made as well.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. You'll know I have got a regional interest with Campbelltown, which I should declare.
Adam specifically, and then John on the spaceport.
Sorry,
Sure, I'm still on the same issue, convener.
Right, okay.
Yeah, I'm still on the spaceport issue. As I said, I've got a regional interest in Campbelltown. Has there been any discussions about having a joint bid with Prestwick in terms of a Scotland United bid, albeit in two sites?
There have been discussions about how the two, Campbelltown and Prestwick, could jointly go forward, but I don't know whether John has more up-to-date information on that.
Yes, I can confirm that there have been discussions. There was a meeting in the last couple of weeks between members of my team, Scottish Enterprise, Highlands and Islands Enterprise, and representatives from both Prestwick and Campbelltown. One of the outcomes of that meeting was that the two airport teams were going to have a further discussion about possible collaboration on a joint bid. We'll keep the committee updated as that progresses.
Yeah, I think back to you, convener. I think you wanted to bring other members.
Did you still have a question, Adam?
Yeah, well, I'm very grateful for that last response. I did suggest something along those lines in the members' business debate that John Scott proposed, so I'm pleased that that's happening. Because up until now, the Scottish Government has basically said we're neutral because we have a number of bidders. Being neutral doesn't mean you're inactive, though, I suggest, and it certainly would appear to me to be a good idea for the government to facilitate a Scottish bid, as it were, hopefully incorporating the best elements of all the various bids. Is that what you have in mind?
Well, I think that decision has to be reached by the two airports. There's two reasons why we're neutral. One, because we should be neutral as between different interests in Scotland. However, with Prestwick Airport, of course, we are the owners. We cannot be, pushing forward our the airport that we own at the expense of other airports, albeit the relationship we have with Campbelltown as well. But so we've taken that neutral approach, but you're right to say we've not been inactive, so the government agencies which are relevant here have been put at the disposal of any bidders in Scotland, Scottish Enterprise, Highlands Development Enterprise, to help them out as much as possible. We've been as active as we can be. Whether they come together, though, has to be a decision of both the airports. But as John has mentioned, there are some promising signs that they might do that.
You wouldn't need to be neutral anymore.
If there's one Scottish bid, then we would push as hard as we possibly can. As we're doing with them individually just now, we push as hard as we possibly can with the UK government to try and ensure it succeeds.
John, did you want to come in on this? Thank you, convener. Yes. Although I pay tribute to my colleagues in the committee, I already asked all the questions I might have asked, by and large. But have you had any discussions, Cabinet Secretary, with the new UK government about this, even if Campbelltown and Prestwick are in contention, but about perhaps both of them being the preferred option for the United Kingdom, or jointly or separately?
I think the discussions which have taken place have really been about trying to understand the process. So I don't think, but John can come in and confirm this, I don't think we would have a discussion about a potential joint or sole bid until we know that's to be the case. But everyone, I think, is waiting for the technical information to come from the UK government, which will help make that decision. I don't know if there's been any further discussion, John.
I myself and a member of my team went to see DfT officials at the end of May, to try to get some clarity on the process as the Cabinet Secretary describes. We still await the Westminster Government providing further details of the specific criteria and the bid process. And until we get that, it's very difficult for any of the potential airfields to take a view on how best to frame their bid. But we'll continue to offer all the support we can from Transport Scotland and the other agencies to any of the airfields in Scotland that want to pursue this.
Thank you.
Okay, David, back to you.
Thank you. Just for completeness, Cabinet Secretary, could I just ask about Stornoway? You'll know that I have a high regard for Heil and have visited most of the airports and have a good relationship with Heil management. Clearly, Stornoway is a vitally important airport and is part of the Heil Group, but clearly you run Hyle. Was there any discussions, advice or guidance to Hyle management to say that Stornoway should be taken out of the bidding process, or was it purely and simply done by the management of Hansans Airports?
No, there was no instruction given, and we don't run it. We do own it, as you say, but it's run by people that you know at Hyle. And they came forward, I mean, I'll just confirm with officials, there was no instruction given by me for them not to, to run that. They took that decision. I don't know if there's anything you want to add, John.
That's absolutely right. I mean, the view of the Hyle board, and they've said this publicly, is that they considered this and they decided that they wanted to concentrate on their core business at Stornoway. There were some practical issues around if the around the use of airspace, which the current scheduled services at Stornoway might have been disrupted by mm-hmm. its use as a spaceport. So in all those circumstances, and also having regard to the resources that might be required, the board of Hyle decided not to pursue a bid for the spaceport.
Okay, that's useful just to put that on the record. Could just move on then to wider issues about Prestwick, Cabinet Secretary. Are there any plans to realise the value of the airport's land and property assets that are not required for aviation purposes?
Well, you're right. I mean, if you go around the airport, you'll realise how substantial it is. So some surplus land there in the airport has already been sold, and the business intends to keep that under review. It's worth, I think, noting that when we bought the land, it came with some pockets of land which are not actually within the airport boundary itself, some of which was originally bought for car parking. So I think from the company's point of view, they'll give careful consideration to ensuring that any sale of land doesn't adversely impact on other long-term aspirations, one of which you've just been discussing in terms of the airport, the spaceport, rather. And as I've said, we have a new series of non-executive directors, and one of them has very particular and broad experience in property in particular, and she'll be able to offer a new source of advice and expertise to the board. So I think that's an area worth keeping our eye on.
Yeah, I think that's a sensible point. You don't want to sterilise future development if you sell off land that you then need for the spaceport. It wouldn't be too clever. So I can understand that. And the final point, what are the key priorities for the strategic and operating company boards for the current financial year?
Just very quickly on the last point, Bristol's obviously have taken a bit of land there for the search and rescue operation, and that's providing a source of revenue, so that's exactly what the kind of thing I want to see. But the priorities for the board are obviously to continue to develop and implement the corporate business plan and to grow all the different aspects of the business, including passengers, but also charters, the fixed-based operations and cargo. Another priorities include, as I've just mentioned, the Bristol search and rescue hangar being completed, and continue to develop that bid for the spaceport. But they'll also be proactively seeking new business opportunities, so they'll consider all credible business propositions. And I get a lot of them sent to me, incidentally, which I just pass straight on to the board, obviously. So there is a great deal of interest out there in people looking at doing business at Prestwick.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Can I thank our witnesses, particularly the Cabinet Secretary, for this evidence session and also the previous evidence session. And I will now suspend this meeting to allow for a changeover of witnesses. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
session, and can I welcome Sarah Boyack, MSP, who will be joining us for this agenda item. Agenda item 4, the committee will continue to take evidence for its piece of work on access to Scotland's major urban railways. Can I welcome Phil Verster, Managing Director, and Susan Anderson, Route Commercial Manager of Network Rail, the Network Rail ScotRail Alliance. Aidan Gricewood, the Director of Rail at Transport Scotland and the Scottish Government. Can I ask Mr. Verster if you'd like to make some very brief opening comments on the nature of the alliance between ScotRail Abellio and Network Rail?
Yes, Convener. First of all, thank you very much for the opportunity to give evidence at this committee hearing today. So we have formed an alliance between the Abellio ScotRail train operating franchise and the Network Rail Scotland route. And what that alliance is basically bringing two businesses together under one senior management team and one managing director. And the focus of this alliance is to basically make the railway better for Scotland, better for our communities, better for our people, and better for our customers. And we've got a very exciting program over the next couple of years. That includes bringing in 234 new electric vehicles, significantly more services, 25% more services in the Central Belt and to places like Stirling, Dunblane and Alloa, bring in intercity service, multiple offers for our customers that are cross-modal in nature, and to be honest, a really exciting program for our customers in our communities. And one of the big focus areas for us is to improve our focus with stakeholders, our focus with customers, and to improve our railway. And in terms of one of the principles that we've set for our business, which is about putting the customers first, the focus on stakeholders, every stakeholder throughout our community, whether it's community rail partnerships, whether it's RTPs, and whether it's councils or local authorities, is to build relationships that allow these stations that you have been taking evidence on to be managed to the best interest of the communities we serve. And so we're very excited about this program, and we'd like today to give some examples of where we know we can do things differently and some examples of where we have done things differently already.
There's a lot of interest in today's evidence session. I know a number of people will be watching, members of the public and stakeholder organisations. So just for clarification, are you able to speak on behalf of Network Rail in terms of this, this piece of work into access to Scotland's urban railway stations?
Yes, I am.
That's fine. I just wanted to be clear about that. There is some confusion amongst those who are watching our proceedings today. Okay, we're going to move on, and the first questions are from Adam Ingram.
Thank you very much, Convener. Now, during the course of this inquiry, the committee has heard that there is no single organisation responsible for coordinating accessibility improvements to Scotland's railway stations, even when they are undergoing major regeneration or improvement. Which organisation should be responsible, in your view, for this work? And why is such coordination not currently happening?
Yes, thank you very much, Mr. Ingram. I think when we think of the integration of transport options across stations, some of the evidence that have been given of correspondence where Network Rail has indicated that Network Rail does not have that strategic transport integration focus may not have been that helpful. I also think it's not that helpful to think that a single organization has that transport integration responsibility. I think what is essential to get this right, and I think the Sostrans view was expressed really well when Sostrans said there must be a seamless passenger experience. That is what we should aim for. Mm-hmm. Now, what clearly needs to be achieved is a mechanism according to which this can be made to work. When we talk about a mechanism and trying to identify a single organization that's accountable, I don't think that's the way we should do this. I think what we should be doing, we can have a simple mechanism that just says who's accountable for getting it started, and that we must identify amongst us. But then the success of getting integration right and that seamless passenger experience is about intent. It's about how a business is run. It's about how all of us work together, and it's about common sense. And so I think one of the important things that we are doing in the Alliance now, for the last month since we formed the Alliance now, is we are focusing all of our business plans on putting the customer first. Mm-hmm. And if I take how big projects work, big projects has a client or a sponsor, which now, for the last month, would be part of the Alliance. Mm-hmm. So with us putting the customer first, I would expect us to play a very different role than what we've played in the past, that we would be able to facilitate exactly that type of discussion, and that even though some parts of large projects sit outside of the Alliance currently, because we look at the operation of the railway, but there are still Network Rail, big, good teams, big teams that do like the Egypt work and the Queen Street work. Those teams take their guidance from what our sponsors in the Alliance say. So the Alliance has a key role going forward, looking after both the ScotRail bit of the business as well as the Scotland route side of Network Rail, to set that involvement and create that involvement, which I think going forward would be different. And if I add one more thing, Mr. Ingram, I think what is really important with these schemes such as Waverley and Queen Street is that these aren't just railway schemes. This is not just about the railway. It's about this community that it falls into. It's about the city that it affects. It's about the town it affects. It's about the flows of traffic, the flows of people. It's about business opportunities. It's about opportunities to leverage in more funds and to integrate the development plans. And I think we realize that. And I think going forward, what you will see now with the role we want to play as an alliance and the role we will play as an alliance is that we expect and we will pace things differently. And in Queen Street's example, for example, would be a really good example of where the teams are setting about now with a focus to create an integrated approach.
So you've obviously heard the evidence that's come to this committee, particularly regarding issues like the metaphorical red line around railway stations, that local authorities in particular have been frustrated and not been able to influence or even have appropriate communications between people who are developing the station and public transport out with the grounds of the station. Do you foresee then, or is one of your tasks in your new coordinated approach will be to address those issues? That will be one of your priorities to tackle.
Yeah. So, Mr. Ingram, this is a really good question, yes. And if I can say, the convener has summarized it, I think, as the three C's of collaboration, coordination, and the third was consultation. Yeah. And I think those three C's becomes the essence of what we need to get right. So if you think of the red line in the sake of Queen Street, perhaps just clarify that Queen Street has got sort of two consultation types of processes going on. On the one hand, there's a Transport and Works Scotland order, which has got very clear consultation duties and requirements to statutory consultees. Mm-hmm. And that becomes a red line area for particular reasons, because it's about ownership and it's about compulsory ownership for a part, for a geographic area. And then I think there's a consultation, another consultation process, we can call it a consultation with a small c, but as important, which is not about the that statutory process to secure ownership of a piece of property, but it's a process about creating that seamless interface. And to answer your question, then, the answer is yes. I do think we have a critical role to play there, but I just want to make it really clear that not the Alliance, not Network Rail, no individual organization can get all of this right. It needs the intent, and it needs the collaboration, and it needs the commitment from all the parties. And I think that would be there personally. But everyone has a role to play. And the thing is, when you look at different cities and you look at different developments, you have to have different approaches. If you look at the good work Dundee is doing with regard to their development, the types of decisions we have made there are different to the decisions in Waverley and are different to the decisions with Queen Street. And I just think this is about finding ways to work together to create solutions rather than sort of targeting one organisation to carry the burden of all of the integration, if you follow on.
Mr. Verster, you said that some of the evidence wasn't helpful, and yet witness after witness after witness has come to the committee, and each and every one of them almost exclusively has said the problem in having a proper dialogue, proper collaboration and so on has been Network Rail. Now, I can understand why you may feel that somewhat unhelpful, and it seems from what you've said that suddenly you've woken up and realised in Network Rail that things can't go on like that. Why weren't you able to put into practice all the virtuous things that you've just laid out before the committee today?
Thank you, Ms. McKenzie. The bit I referred to that was not helpful was the Network Rail correspondence that I referred to. So I didn't refer to any of the submissions by other witnesses to not be helpful. I've personally followed the information presented and the evidence presented to this committee carefully over the last couple of weeks, and personally think all of it's helpful. Yeah, I think some of the correspondence that have changed between businesses was not we could have done this better. I'll give you an example. Sustrans was at one stage engaged with correspondence from us that looked as if it was the type of correspondence we sent to a member of the public. While Sustrans is not a member of the public, they are an influential stakeholder, which we should have approached differently. So my view is, Mr. McKenzie, very, very clearly, is that we have a different business now. We are setting up the Alliance as a different business. We have a very significant, relentless focus on the customer. And maybe if I talk about the rail industry a little bit to just answer that question. The rail industry a couple of years ago were fragmented. And with different parts of the railway industry being in different parts all over the industry, there were practices and ways of working that developed with certain customer focus ideas which are different to what we as people that want to serve the end customer, the fare paying customer, think. And one of the things that Transport Scotland and the Scottish Government has put together is this alliance idea, which is leading, I think, a leading concept in the rail industry, where we bring bits back together again and say, have less interfaces and focus on the end customer. And so that's what we're doing.
Can I take that as a commitment then from Network Rail that you will have a more constructive role within this alliance in the future than we've seen in the past?
You can absolutely take that as a commitment.
Thank you.
Okay, can I say maybe a change, a potential change in practice? Can I give you a for instance here? The committee has heard evidence that the Scottish Station Fund cannot be used for improvements to areas immediately surrounding a railway station, even when they are focusing on improving the accessibility for customers to the station. Is this, in your view, a correct state of affairs? And would you like to see the fund criteria being revised to allow it to finance such improvements?
So thank you, Mr. Ingram. So first of all, I do think that the station fund can be used for applications which the rules that governs the fund allow for. So I think what's really important when you look at the station fund and when you look at City of Edinburgh submission to the station fund, we have a very clear set of rules according to which Network Rail, which is not a funder, we're just administering the fund, and Aidan may talk later about how the administering of the fund is getting changed, according to which the administering of the fund is executed. And the administering of the fund, in very simple terms, is about doing stuff that helps the railway and passengers. Now, rightly or wrongly, that's what the fund is focused on. A very important part of that fund's concept is that anyone that wants to use parts of the fund must get their own development and feasibility work up to a stage of maturity that the fund can actually say, yep, that's £1.7 million is exactly, or whatever the amount is exactly what is going to require, because that's a mature design. Mm-hmm. So that the fund doesn't sign up to a £1.7 million estimate that turns into a £17 million estimate later on, mm-hmm. which happens with these capital projects. Yeah, so it's really, really important that whoever makes an application to the fund actually does that groundwork really, really well. Mm-hmm. And I'll just, I think the question relates to Haymarket, so I'll just answer that question if you don't mind, mm-hmm. and say that we have worked closely, and we will continue to work closely with the City of Edinburgh Council to look at issues like an access from the Dalry side, and to look at what the possibilities are of better access for cyclists. And we will, and we have to, because we've just opened this week. We've opened our bike and go scheme at Haymarket, and we've rented our first bicycle out at Haymarket, which is really exciting for us. So we want to continue these relationships and develop this. But the station fund has got huge demands on it. There are new stations in the offing that may be built from that station fund, and I just think the station fund must be approached within the governing rules that are set out for it.
Okay.
Thank you. Do you have something you'd like to contribute, Mr. Bryce?
Yeah, just to support what Phil was saying there. In terms of the station fund, we've essentially, in terms of the criteria, that's something that Transport Scotland have approved too. And there's some important principles around the fund. First is to make sure that we maximise the impact of the fund. And that requires so the emphasis on leverage, so third-party funding elsewhere as well, to ensure that we get the most out of that fund, because, as Mr. Verster pointed out, there's a limited budget. So ensuring that we do that is a key principle. I think the second key element is that ultimately this is a fund that is borrowed as part of Network Rail's regulatory asset base and is therefore subject to regulatory rules about ensuring that what is undertaken through the station fund is can demonstrably add value to the rail passenger. So there's a set of regulatory requirements about the sorts of things that can be specifically funded by a station fund, and those are set by the Office of the Rail Regulator in terms of the asset base and what borrowing can be undertaken. I think, thirdly, I think just back to the previous discussion about, you know, if you like, the red line issue. I think there's an important distinction between the engagement that needs to happen and is actually actively encouraged through the station fund in terms of participation of local authorities, RTPs, other third parties, and the value that's placed upon third-party contributions and demonstrably showing that this is consistent with local plans, regional plans, and national plans. And secondly, the actual funding around that. So I think it's an imperative, and sort of already talk about this, in terms of ensuring that we get all of these, this is an opportunity, just like a major station development, it's a huge opportunity presented by funding to actually get parties together, work collaboratively, think about how the overall end-to-end journey can be improved for the benefit of the passenger. And similarly, the station fund, it's an opportunity that's presented. It's a, you know, a reasonable slab of money committed there to improve stations. But it's all about bringing people, using that as a means of bringing people to sit round and think about what is best for the end-to-end journey. And that means, you know, working very closely with local authorities, RTPs, in terms of them putting together proposals. But ultimately, you know, the funding that can be presented through the station fund has to be predominantly for the benefit of rail passengers. So I think if we're talking about things like road improvements and the like, then that's clearly out with scope. Although I think those sorts of investments made by third parties would be very positive in terms of demonstrably showing that leverage is being brought and the station fund is maximising its impact.
Okay, thank you. We're going to move on to the issue of access to Edinburgh Waverley, and David Stewart's going to
lead off. On the theme of consultation and communication, why was vehicle access to Edinburgh Waverley station removed?
So in May last year, that access for road vehicles to the concourse area was removed. And it was removed at very short notice. And this was triggered by a fatality, a safety incident, whereby a vehicle that was approaching the ramps reversed, did funny things, person lost control of the vehicle, and it had a very tragic consequence of hurting a pedestrian, and severely. And the pedestrian died. And for safety considerations, the decision was made to limit road access into Waverley. If I could put this into context, Waverley, from all the managed stations that Network Rail has, both in Scotland, the two in Scotland, as well as through the rest of the UK, Waverley was the last station that still allowed vehicles onto the concourse area. And with over a period of time, based on just security reasons, and obviously the decision in the end for safety reasons, that decision was made. So it's always easier in hindsight to take stock of how things were done at the time. And I think it's fair to say that process could have been consulted better. So when you have a risk, there are ways that you can contain and mitigate a risk in the short term, which may not be feasible to do in the long term, but you could have. We must in future think of how we do things in the short term to allow all of the other affected parties to adjust accordingly. And I think that's a lesson that we can take away from Waverley specifically. However, at the time, I can envisage the decision made for the strong safety reasons there were.
As you talked earlier about partnership, and you'll recall last week we took evidence from the Convener of Transport from the City of Edinburgh Council, and frankly they were kept in the dark about this. They told the committee that they read about it in the local press. Now that doesn't seem to me to be very good partnership working. Why were they not brought into this equation before this decision was made?
Yeah. Mr. Stewart, I can only agree with you that the consultation should not work like that. The consultation should be better, and the consultation can be better. And if I could give you an example, customers have been, since I've joined the business a month ago, customers have been knocking on my door about cycling access at Waverley. And I have personally gone down and I've looked at how the ramps work, I've looked at how deliveries work, and I've also looked at how our risk assessments have been done. And I think there's a different solution out there that can be implemented, which could be a lot better for cycling.
Yeah,
and
just sorry, I will be asking you questions about that later, just
okay.
Because I know the convener is conscious of time. Could I ask some very specific questions? Some of the committee members, including myself, have picked up informally that the reason for the decision, notwithstanding the dreadful fatality, was from specific security advice. Could I ask you on the record whether you've had specific security advice from the Centre for the Protection of National Infrastructure, the security services, or the police to say that below ground stations like Waverley should no longer have vehicle access, because that's important for our consideration. Have you received any specific advice? I don't need to know the content of the advice, merely if you've received it. If you're not able to tell me now, perhaps you could write to the committee clerks and tell us whether that information was received.
Yes. So can I take that away as something I can correspond to this committee on separately? What I can say at this point, some of the evidence sessions flighted the concern that the decision to close Waverley was somehow, and I think the words were used, a diktat from somewhere in the UK or advice from somewhere else, and just confirmed that that was not the case. That decision was made locally, was made by the local team on the basis of the safety considerations. The separate question on whether information was given or instruction or guidance were given for security reasons, I would like to address separately, if that's okay.
I won't continue. It's merely to say that I think it was the question was referring to was mine. The issue about whether a decision was made locally or not was not really the issue. A local team could make a decision to close vehicles coming to Waverley on security advice received elsewhere. That's perfectly appropriate, perfectly understandable. The committee just wished to know whether security advice led to vehicles being stopped coming into Waverley. That's what the committee would like to know.
Yes, and we'll respond on that.
And just when I'm on the theme, you mentioned yourself delivery vehicles and rail replacement buses. They're still allowed onto the concourse. You can see there's a potential dilemma here. If on the one hand you're saying we're stopping vehicles, or by the way, we're stopping delivery vehicles coming into Waverley, if it's for safety reasons, why have you still got these vehicles coming into Waverley Concourse?
Yes. So in terms of delivery vehicles and not other vehicles, if, as you can imagine, accommodating delivery vehicles is significantly less vehicle movements and therefore significantly less risk for our customers. Mm. Also, delivery vehicles can be scheduled, and we are in the process now of rescheduling delivery vehicles to hours which are the hours of the night when customers are not on the concourse. So on any day, you'll see very few delivery vehicles during the day that pose a threat to customers at all. And the delivery vehicles are really, really critical because that keeps all of our customer facilities, retail facilities on the station itself going. And in that regard, we are also doing interesting things with regard to complicated articulated vehicle deliveries, which pose a risk to cyclists using those same ramps, as well as pose a risk to the infrastructure. So the issue of delivery vehicles is more about control of vehicles rather than have this unfettered access of many, many vehicle movements across the concourse area.
And rail replacement buses also use the concourse, I believe.
Yeah, it uses the ramps, but in a controlled fashion.
I'll come back to you later on in terms of bike access. Could I put back to the convener?
Thank you. Mr. Verster, you've given a commitment this morning, still in the morning, to write to the committee outlining the security advice on which decisions taken to ban vehicle access to Waverley Station was taken. And when you do that, could you also address the point that was made by Network Rail in February 2012 that the reason why they were seeking to ban vehicles was in the run-up to the 2012 Olympic Games, and that there was an anti-terrorism purpose in banning vehicles. If you could cover off that point as well, that would be helpful when you write to the committee. Can I take you back to the point about consultation? And I was interested that when you mentioned the three C's earlier, collaboration, coordination, you did hesitate at the point where you introduced the word consultation. And I have to say, if I'm being honest, I'm not surprised, because the evidence that we've received as a committee has been quite damning in terms of Network Rail's lack of consultation on the decisions to ban vehicles to Waverley Station. And if I could just remind you, you know, we had six separate pieces of evidence from our witnesses. Tony Kenmuir from the Scottish Taxi Federation, when asked what consultation did Network Rail engage in prior to imposing the station vehicle ban, he said none whatsoever. John Lauder from Sustrans said none. Nathan Kitchmarsky from Cycling Scotland said, when asked, so there has not been any formal consultation, he said not with us. Anne McLean of the Mobility and Access Committee for Scotland said there was no consultation with us at all. John Warren of Transform Scotland said there was none at all. And Councillor Leslie Hines last week, when asked, said there was no consultation of the council on taking all taxis out of the station. Now, what does that say about the reputation of Network Rail as a public body funded by the taxpayer and accountable to ministers, that there has been no consultation or a distinct lack of consultation with your key stakeholders?
Yes, convener, thank you very much for that. Over the last, if I took Edinburgh Waverley and think about the last 7 years, we have invested around £50 million in Waverley. And all of that has been in the interest of customers. And all of those changes and all of the specification aspects and what we've implemented were consulted. The one bit that was not thoroughly consulted on was the quick decision on access of vehicles to the concourse area itself. And so just put in context the fact that these are really big programs, and consultation around these big programs are not as you have just portrayed it. If I take Egypt, which is a £740 million program, we've had more than 400 consultations with communities on Egypt as well.
That's fine, but we're talking specifically about access to Scotland's major urban railways, and we're talking about access to the major railway in our capital city, which is the gateway to the rest of Scotland. And the overwhelming evidence that we've received is that Network Rail has failed in their public duty to consult with stakeholders on access to that station.
Yeah. And I think, convener, as I've indicated before, I think there's a huge area for improvement in terms of consultation. That's possible. I also think in the context of what has been done to date at Waverley, has included multiple parties, multiple groups, and we have ongoing meetings with City of Edinburgh Council on a quarterly basis in terms of their aspirations, and also with groups, accessibility groups and interest groups as well. Mm-hmm. So I take the point very firmly that there's room for improvement, and we will endeavour to do that.
Okay. I accept that there's been ongoing discussions with the City of Edinburgh Council over a period of time, but they clearly feel that there has been, to use your phrase, diktat in terms of decisions being imposed on them by Network Rail. So what steps will you take to improve that relationship with the City of Edinburgh Council?
So one of the biggest steps we have taken is to bring the train operating business and the Scotland Route Network Rail business under one umbrella, and to create a singular focus on putting the customer first. And in terms of how we set out the business and how we're now reorganizing the business, is all around putting the customer first and delivering that for the customer. And one of the things that we are intending to do now is that for the next phases of development, such as the developments around Waverley, such as where we can possibly locate the taxi rank at the old fruit market. We'll engage with SOSTRANS, SESTRANS, and the City of Edinburgh Council and fully discuss these ideas with them at the planning phases already and not at the delivery phases. And I can see that if you start to discuss what you're going to do at the delivery phases, that it's too late. And it needs to be discussed at the planning phases. And that is where we are moving towards. I just would like to say, convener, is that there is a huge continuous consultation process at all times between our strategy and planning business, as well as the RTPs and local authorities at the regular rail forums, that continues throughout the year, and there are good relationships there. I do think at times some decisions may not feel as if it's thoroughly consulted, and I think we can do better.
Okay. You've talked about putting the customer first. Can I ask you about putting the disabled customer first? Because we heard evidence from organisations representing disabled people and people who have disability and mobility issues, and they have been very clear in their evidence that the accessibility of Edinburgh Waverley Station is not as good as it was and not as good as it should be. And notwithstanding the investment that Network Rail has made, they feel that their experience as a disabled passenger is worse than it was.
Yeah. So that evidence that's been given has been very, very useful for us. We need to learn how to do this differently and do this better. But if I can just start off by saying, what we have now at Waverley is step-free access and lifts at all of our entrances. And if I just build on that a little bit, if you like, take the New Street car park, for example, we have step-free access from the car park, plus we give the people that travel with our people with reduced mobility can have a 40-minute free parking to accompany their passenger all the way onto the concourse. At the Colton Road side, we are looking now at, based on feedback that we've had from and stakeholder feedback we've had, we're looking at alternative arrangements to provide a sheltered accommodation and even operational fixes to allow for a better accommodation of people with reduced mobility. And I think there's so much that we are doing for where Waverley is now relative to it was before that allow for access for people with reduced mobility. We have taken audits and feedback from interest groups like Deafblind Scotland, and we've taken that forward in terms of action plans to get better signage and to get and to improve the railway and the station for people with reduced mobility as well. So I think we're listening. I know we're listening, and I think we're making it better.
Okay. Maybe some of my colleagues wish to pursue that issue later on in our session. Can I move us on to the issue of access into the station for cyclists? And I know that that's a particular interest of my colleague Sarah Boyack, MSP, and also of my colleague Alison Johnson, MSP, and all of us have written to Network Rail on this subject. The perception of access to Edinburgh Waverley at the moment is best summed up in the phrase Fortress Waverley, which is used by cyclists. And I was struck by what you said earlier, when you, with some degree of pride as someone coming from a country that has a better record on cycling than we do in this country, you talked about the Bike and Go scheme. But cyclists view with incredulity a Bike and Go scheme at Edinburgh Waverley that involves cyclists having to push their bike into the station and push their bike out of the station. So you have a Bike and Go scheme, or the aspiration to implement a Bike and Go scheme, but you aren't able to facilitate cyclists being able to cycle in and out of the station. That seems to me to be rather absurd.
I can only agree.
And that's one of the reasons why I take a personal interest in this. And that's one of the reasons why I've gone and looked at it myself. And I'm working with my teams. I think it's important, Mr. Convener, just to figure it out like this, and this is the way I think about it. Where we have to fix things and do things differently than what we have done before, I'm very keen to bring the people in my teams with me in terms of how they look at the future, how they see our focus on customers, and how they adjust their approach to making decisions so that we add up to a team of leaders that make decisions in the customer interest. And so one of the things that we are doing at Waverley is we're working through the previous decisions that have been made, and we're looking at how to change these decisions into something that's more customer friendly. And I see a huge cycling opportunity at Waverley, and I do see a change from where we are now.
Okay. I'm very reassured by that statement and the tone and content of your responses. But it's interesting that in January 2014, Network Rail were willing to adapt access so that the North Ramp could facilitate cyclists being able to cycle into the station. But they then took a decision to reverse that, so denying cyclists access. Are you able to give a commitment today that you will revisit that decision, that you will look at reopening the North Ramp for cyclists and in order to ease the pressure that there currently is on a very narrow space being occupied by cyclists, pedestrians, tourists and others in and out of the station?
The current practice where the cyclist must push his bicycle, his or her bicycle, on the same pathway that pedestrians use is just not sustainable for me. And I don't want to make a commitment on the North Ramp, convener, but I want to make a commitment that we're going to come up with something, either North Ramp or South Ramp, that's going to work better. And one of the solutions could be, if we remove the articulated vehicles off the South Ramp, that we have no vehicles required on that ramp and use the South Ramp. So in terms of the commitment you're asking for, I can say it's an easy one to give, because I've already started that process, as I've given you an indication of, and in the next couple of weeks we'll be completing that, and we'll start to put in place something that's better.
Okay, thank you for that. I'm going to hand over to Sarah Boyack.
Thank you very much, Convener. And can I first of all thank the committee for conducting this inquiry in the first place? This is one of the issues that my constituents raise with me on a regular basis. And having been the first transport minister in this place and kicking off that big investment in the railway, it's a source of pride that there's huge change to Waverley Station, but also massive annoyance that there are some areas that have actually gone backwards. And I think the ramps point you make is an issue for cyclists, but is also for older people, people with disabilities, passengers with luggage, because there's physically not enough space. I do that regularly with my own bike. And you think through the opportunities. So for me, it's about access to get to the station. It's about access in and out of the station, and then it's access on and off trains. And the challenge is that it needs to work for all your passengers all the time, every day. And I had a great meeting with Susan Anderson and her colleagues last month, and I took with me one constituent in a wheelchair, one constituent who's blind, and I brought my cycling eyes and the views of lots of constituents. And what really struck me was that the staff were enthusiastic and keen to listen to us, but a lot of the ideas we were talking about, the reality check was almost like a revelation. So I think there's a lot of work needs to be done there. I very much welcome that commitment on the ramps, because you've no idea how annoying that is for huge numbers of your passengers. So I think you talked about the big improvement. The ramps need to be fixed. The escalators to the north are brilliant, but regularly one of them doesn't work. So you see people with luggage, particularly older people or people with families, really struggling, because they then have to revert to steps. The Colton Road drop-off point, I have people reporting to me that they park there, they've phoned in advance, they ring the phone once they get in there, and they can wait in the cold for a long period of time. So it's checking every single entrance, checking it from all the different perspectives. And I think the crucial thing is physical changes, signage in the station, which isn't good enough, particularly when you're changing. If people go and the arrangement is different from one week to the other, that's a problem. because you've got to deal with commuters, people who are using it for leisure purposes, and people who are tourists. So not everybody's got the day-to-day knowledge of the station. And I suppose the other thing I would say is that there's also a staff issue of making sure that the staff are geared up in the station to support people who've got disabilities. And also, having seen your new cycle innovation plan, on the page it looks wonderful. Actually translating that into practice, I think, we held a meeting with Spokes, and I think it was Des Bradley who was the nominated person from ScotRail this week, and he took a lot of very detailed questions about things that need to be fixed. So I think the mood music is fantastic, and if the ramp can be addressed, people will celebrate that across the city. But there's a lot of other things I think need to be particularly addressed in terms of cycle access into the station to make it easier and to talk to cyclists. I mean, one of the things I was shown at the Cochrane Road access was a very steep cycle rail up, so you push your bicycle up beside the steps. Actually, not all cyclists have got the physical capacity to do that, so I think you need to check out the range of different users. And I think the hope for the future is definitely there in the cycle improvement plan, but it's actually seeing the change implemented in practice. So I think for me, I go back to that first point. Passengers need to get to the railway station, they need to get in and out of the station, and they need to get on and off trains. And a big issue raised at the meeting on Monday was access on trains. The new idea about new bikes at the station that people can rent, I think will suit a lot of people, but there are also people who will want to take their bikes with them, for example, to the Borders Railway. And two spaces on the train is not going to work. So thank you very much,
Points, if
convener.
You want to come back, you can. Mr. Verster.
Yeah, thank you very much, convener. Ms. Boyack, there's very little of what you've said that I don't fully and wholeheartedly agree with. It is an absolute objective for us to provide this multimodal ability for our customers to bring bicycles with them on our trains, and to travel with bicycles in a way that is effective and easy. And so, together with the idea of just traveling as a passenger and renting a bicycle, this all contributes to the broader focus of the Scottish Government to encourage 10% of journeys to be by bicycles in 2020. So we're very much switched on to that. And I do think that you are right as well on the fact that it's in the detail where the solutions lie. Colton Road, for example, is a point of access. We should be using the lifts. Consider how we use the lifts for bicycles. And in terms of the contingency plans for escalators, I think we should communicate clearer that the contingency plan is not then to use the stairs or the steps, but to actually use the lifts that are there for anyone with big luggage. And I think it is about, as you say, the awareness of our staff, the awareness of our teams on the ground to help people. And we'll take those comments away in the constructive spirit to share. Thank you very much.
A timetable convener, so that we know when changes are being made, so that starts to get communicated. I think that would be really useful.
And as part of what I wanted to offer this committee is I'm willing to provide on Waverley Station definitely a timetable for programme of work, also for this committee. I'm willing to come back to this committee every year, every 6 months, whatever you think is appropriate, to give you an update on where we are with issues in this realm of what you've discussed with us this morning.
Thank you very much for that. That's much appreciated. Mary, you had a very small supplementary.
Yes, it was just a very, very small point I wanted to make, and it was in relation to the point that my colleague Sarah Boyack raised in regards to the work that had been done on the stairs and on the Colton Road entrance, so that to allow customers to push their bicycle up. It was pointed out to me that where the groove has been put in on the stairs, it's too near the wall, and you can't actually push your bike up because there's not enough width for the handlebars. And I did go and have a look at it, and it is far too close to the wall. You would not be able to push a bicycle up that groove.
Thank you very much. We'll definitely take that away.
On David, do you have some questions?
How will the Network Rail ScotRail Alliance work in practice? What will the advantages be to passengers, particularly around improvements to the accessibility of Scottish railway stations?
So, in practice, the Alliance is a combination of two businesses. It's putting two teams together, and more than that, it's taking parts of one organization and moving it to another organization and vice versa. So it's not just bundling two businesses together side by side with an uncomfortable relationship. It's an integration of two businesses and creating an entity, a one-team entity that focus on the customer relentlessly and take all of our business strategy, take all of our actions and our team focus back to that one single focus on our customer and growing our business for in the interest of our customers. And in response to your question, Mr. Stewart, I see that as the biggest single change from where we were before. Because most of the things that get done in complicated industries and complicated businesses depend on the starting point and the orientation of the business and what the teams think they are there to achieve. And what we are setting out in our business is a focus for our teams to succeed in this customer focus. And so there are initiatives which range from long-term strategic plans, which will now obviously have that customer focus aspect to it, down to shorter-term plans, which are about day-to-day management of station facilities and station condition. And in that spectrum, we involve parts of Network Rail that look forward 50 years in terms of their planning horizon to other parts of Network, other parts of our alliance that look in a two-week cycle forward in terms of their planning in order to deliver a better customer experience. And I think what we are doing now is bring that all together under one single focus.
I mean, I think that's an interesting model, but for ordinary passengers, particularly those with a disability, you'd be judged on what actions you have and how you deliver. Do you agree with that?
I do. And in order for us to better understand and continuously engage with disability groups, we are putting together a customer equality forum where we will include all of the disability groups and other interest groups and other stakeholders. And that forum will be the place where we keep pace with concerns and opinions about particular specific issues. I just want to add to that, I've met recently with the chairs of the RTPs, and I have committed to see the RTPs once a year, and we'll send senior representation to every quarterly meeting. And I think you're right. In the end, customers will measure us by what happens on the ground, and that is what we'll focus on. By using these stakeholder forums, we will create opportunities for people to feed back to us if there are parts of our delivery that doesn't meet those requirements.
I mean, every transport conference I've ever gone to, we always talk about integration between different modes of transport. People who use rail don't just use rail. They use bus, they might cycle, they might walk. Signage is going to be absolutely crucial here. How important then is signing other modes? For example, this is for the buses, this is where the tram is, this is how you get a bike. This is the walking route between, albeit it might not be your station, between Central and Queen Street. All these things are vital. There has been some complaints about lack of signage. Will the new integration mean a better job for signage across our Scottish stations?
Yes. So, Mr. Stewart, the answer is unambiguously yes. And we have a committed obligation to bring better wayfinding and signage around stations to other attractions within the different cities and towns where we have services and where there are attractions that lead people to do other things. That's good in so many ways, not just for passengers to understand where to go, but that's part of our strategy to develop our own footfall and customer base when there's more clarity for our customers on what attractions are in other cities. And every time we have customers that better understand what the exciting opportunities are in other cities, that's more journeys for us. So we are committed to that, and we have a plan and a program to deliver that. And I think we'll come back in our future sessions and give you an update on that as well.
My final question, I'm conscious of time, convener, is witnesses and our survey respondents, which incidentally we got, I think, one of the highest responses to survey of any committee, which we're very pleased about, called for an increase in well-sited secure cycle parking at railway stations, something that your home nation is very good at.
Yes.
We need to do more about that, because clearly some people turn up with bikes and find that there's no secure access for them, or they're not covered, something the Netherlands does extremely well. What plans do you have to improve this aspect to encourage active travel?
So we are adding more than 3,500 cycle berths in the first 3 years of our tenure. And part of that is the creation of cycle points. Part of that is the creation of cycle parks. And we have a very clear station-by-station plan and commitment to add these additional cycle spaces. So that is another aspect where we have a clear program for and which we can share with you.
Right, thank you. I'm very conscious of time, so I'll hand back to the convener.
Thank you. Committee heard in evidence that Network Rail normally focuses on access issues within its stations, leaving the development of external areas, surrounding areas, to other authorities, particularly local authorities. I'm just wondering what steps you are intending to take to improve collaboration and coordination between the areas that Network Rail is responsible for and the areas that local authorities are responsible for in order to deliver the integrated solutions that we want to see.
So, convener, thank you for that. I don't see any other way of doing that but through multi-party collaboration and a focus on the customer. I can see that some other form of a structure to say at least one party must trigger this process is a good practice. But from that point onwards, all of the interested parties need to collaborate, need to work together to come up with that seamless experience for customers. And so what we commit to from the ScotRail Alliance is we have the accountability to provide sponsors and clients for these large projects. And so the sponsors and clients will take that accountability to get the ball rolling and to get all of the parties around the table. And from that point onwards, there are very complicated issues that then happen. If I take Glasgow Queen Street and some of the contractual interactions with the development of Buchanan Galleries is an interesting and really important phase of creating an integrated solution. And so every project will have different challenges and different issues, which will be in the hands of all of the parties that are involved to work together to come to an outcome. And at times, there will be compromises that will be made. There will be solutions that can't be afforded. Those are very difficult decisions that depend not on one party only, and not one party can take accountability for that. But what I commit to this committee to is that I think we'll always now be in the position to start the ball rolling on that type of cross-party collaboration. Mm-hmm. From that point onwards, it's very much in the hands of all of the contributing parties.
Okay, thank you for that. There was some concern expressed by some of our witnesses about the governance arrangements that apply to decisions taken by Network Rail. Can you say a little bit about what your decision-making process is within Network Rail for decisions on access to stations, and you know, which of these decisions are, you talked about decisions having been taken locally at Waverley, but which of these decisions are local, which are Scottish and which are UK? Can you give us an insight into that, and can you also say what, in view of the feedback that you will have had and from the evidence sessions that we've had, what steps you're taking to increase the transparency of your decision-making process, particularly at a Scottish level?
Yes. So I think there's probably one division of responsibilities that I think is really important to understand, that would then, from that point onwards, help everyone to picture how the governance works. And that one division is the division between funder and deliverer. Aidan would probably add to this discussion with his clarification on the roles of the funder. And sometimes Network Rail is perceived as a funder when it's not. Network Rail often manages funds, like the station fund, according to a set of criteria that must then be met. And the governance around how a fund is assigned and allocated is very transparent, very clear. The rules are clear. The communication around those are clear. So then when you look down the delivery chain, having distinguished between the delivery and the funding chain, around the delivery chain, the governance sits with a set of sponsors and clients, which works for Susan Anderson, who's my route commercial manager. And in Susan's team, there's the sponsor and clienting responsibility. Now, what the sponsor and client does is they basically say, those are the outputs that the funder wants. We are now going to have a project over a year that's going to deliver it. And the sponsor and client must make sure that that delivery stays on track, doesn't deliver something that's less than what was specified, doesn't go off and deliver more that was specified and then cause an overrun in cost. So the client-sponsor role is a really, really important role. That client-sponsor role sits within the ScotRail Alliance, which is quite exciting in the sense because for the first time, that sponsorship role is really closely related to the train operating company part of the ScotRail Alliance. So you can make that link to the primacy of the customer. Then if you think of the client and sponsor then as sort of the conductor that makes sure that the orchestra stays in tune, then we have below that a project governance structure which can be different project contractual agreements, either at arm's length contracting or alliances or partnerships, but we then have a part of Network Rail called Network Rail Infrastructure Projects that basically take these big projects and set up long, big programs of work, like if you think of Egypt, £742 million. That includes Queen Street, of course, and includes parts of Waverley, of course, all sits under Egypt. That then runs as a program of works, and the decision that's made in Egypt is open for discussion on a regular basis. We now have in Egypt a review with stakeholders on where the program is. We share that governance in terms of decisions we make on Egypt, where we are reporting-wise with Transport Scotland. Transport Scotland supports and helps the stakeholders and the sponsors and the clients to keep us on the right track. So that's the structure of governance. I can add one more thing. Since I've taken my role, I've implemented a monthly governance structure in week two of every railway period, whereby these projects report back on their progress to me as well. And so we close the loop between these big programs that work on the long multi-year timelines through a monthly periodic review where the sponsor sits in the same room with myself and with my team to give feedback on where the progress is.
Just on the specific point of what steps you're taking to increase transparency of the governance process and decision-making process that you've described, are there any plans to take that forward?
Yes, so I think Susan would take an opportunity to discuss some of the changes we are making now to governance, and we have already decided that we will involve RTPs in the regular and councils and interested parties in the regular update of where the programmes are. Susan.
The other thing that we've introduced is a control room concept, whereby we use visualisation as the means in which we're imparting information. Everything is on the wall. Everything we want to talk about is on the wall. It's not hidden in a room. It's open. It's available for anyone who wants to come into our office. We have a weekly meeting measuring all of our projects and talking through progress on all of our projects. And we've invited Transport Scotland into those meetings. So there's full transparency and visibility on everything we do. Anything that any specific project anybody wants information on, please let us know and we will share that with you. But we are fully transparent and visible.
We're going to move on just because of the restrictions of time. James, you have some questions.
Thank you, Convener. Mr. Verster, your opening comments, you talked about putting customers first and a seamless passenger experience, yet the committee's heard concerns from witnesses about an apparent unwillingness of Network Rail to engage in access issues related to the redevelopment of Glasgow Queen Street. Would you consider these concerns justified? And if so, how is Network Rail now working with stakeholders to address these concerns?
I do think those concerns are justified. So I do think we're in a position now where the information and the evidence that we've had from the committee has been very clear, and where we have, as an organisation, opportunities to improve consultation, especially the consultation outside of the TORS order, and to create that seamless interface that Sustrans have commented on. I think it's really important, and I think we have already adjusted our approach to Queen Street, and I'm confident that going forward that our consultation with stakeholders such as Sustrans on Queen Street will be better.
Okay. I know that time's a bit limited, but can you expand on what you mean by you've changed things around Queen Street?
We've had two phases of consultation for the Queen Street redevelopment, and as a result of those two phases of consultation, we've actually made significant changes to the design of the station, taking on board the views of what the consultation responses generated. Some examples of that were the previous design had the access ramp for the station out with the glass frontage. It's now going to be contained within the frontage of the station so that there's a weatherproof access and it feels very much more part of the footprint of the station. We've also taken on board the comments that the taxi drop-off facility was not forming part of the station footprint, and that will now be enshrined as part of the galleries development that's working in parallel with the station. We've also taken on board comments around the siting of toilets, left luggage and baby change facilities, all again to make it more of a customer-focused environment. And we're also very alive to the issues that Sustrans have raised regarding the need for cycle hub provision. And we're looking at facilities in Dundas Street and also a facility coming off Cathedral Street. So as a result of all that consultation, there's a whole load of issues have come back to us, which we're really, really welcoming to hear, and we're working very hard to try and address them.
Yeah, and we come back to you at some stage about the taxi rank particularly, but that's very interesting to hear. SPT took the unprecedented step of contacting the Office of Rail Regulation about the redevelopment of the North Hanover Street car park at Queen Street Station, as it felt Network Rail had not properly represented its views on the matter.
Can you explain how this situation arose? Can we get assurances that can't happen again? And is there any mechanism now in place that would mean, for example, that SPT would be able to make that representation themselves?
So I'm not familiar with the details of that particular representation, but I would strongly...
I suppose the main issue here is the fact that SPT went through you, you in their view, they weren't represented appropriately, and that was accepted by the ORR, and then I believe that SPT managed to make the representation themselves. Yeah. Is there any mechanism for them to bypass you in a situation like that, to go to the ORR?
Yeah, instead of commenting on whether there's a mechanism to bypass us, I think where we should get to is that there's no need for them to bypass us. We have enough collaboration on the ground and enough interaction, and not only a forum where people talk, but also a genuine intent. I think sometimes you can talk to people without them feeling there's a genuine intent to listen. And I think that's really, from all of the evidence that I think has come to this committee, I think that's one of the messages that's really, really clear to me, is that the approach needs to be about listening and listening more. On Queen Street, there is a forum whereby the stakeholders participate in the consultation, and we will make sure that that forum works better.
We'll hold you to that.
Yeah.
And my last question is, Network Rail enjoys wide-ranging permitted development rights. The committee's heard evidence that this means Network Rail does not normally engage with local authorities in planning matters or contribute to improvements in coordination with other transport modes around the station, which we've discussed on a number of occasions so far. Would you say this was correct? And if so, how do you intend to improve the engagement on planning matters?
So I can see that permitted development rights can lead to a situation whereby some developments are progressed reasonably quickly with a big focus on delivering the outputs. I can also see that consultation processes are really, really important, and that not always will you find that a consultation process gives all of the answers that makes everyone happy. I've not looked in detail at cases where permitted development rights in Scotland have been used or have caused consultations to be less effective. And I think what we have to do, similar to the message we've given on one or two previous examples, we have to make sure that even when there are developments that are proceeding under permitted development rights, that our sponsor and our client that looks after those developments make sure that the consultation is triggered properly and that all of the local authorities and all of the interested parties are consulted in that process. So I would like to give the same answer as we've given on any of the other examples, such as Queen Street, that this is all about the intent and all about how we focus on the customer. And I do think we have an opportunity to improve on that.
Yeah, so it'd be interesting if you did go back and have a look at it to see, for example, if Queen Street or one of the others was a case of that, because it suggests that there might be that red line that we talked about earlier on, where you're not taking into account the other modes of transport that lead you to get to the station in the first place. So it might be helpful if you come back to us with something on that.
We'll do that. Thank you very much, Mr. Dorner.
Thank you, Alex. Thank you very much, Convener. Before we all desperately get out of here, I've got three quick questions for Transport Scotland. The first is that Transport Scotland, of course, is the strategic direction of Network Rail Scotland and specifies the ScotRail franchise. Can you tell me, do you feel that that arrangement gives you the necessary muscle to ensure that these organisations do take the right action when they are dealing with interaction with other modes of transport? It'll come on for you.
Okay, automatic. I think it does give us big opportunities. So I think the opportunity that was, I think, taken in terms of the specification for the current franchise and the level of consultation that took place around that and the focus that was put into the specification on integration in particular. So the onus on quality, not just price and the franchise, that the weighty marks that were rewarded in terms of commitments that were made around integration and indeed also on accessibility as part of that over and above the legal requirements expected of the operator and now have been fed through and I think the reaction in terms of the successful bidder for Abellio in running the franchise and their cycle plan and the like is a direct consequence of us putting in place in that specification the opportunity for them to essentially win the franchise through demonstrably showing that they can make those sorts of improvements. So we've now got all of those set in terms of a wide range of contractual obligations when it comes to terms of things like the commitments made about cycle provision, commitments made around improved spontaneous travel for disabled passengers, for example, just to name a couple, but a whole series of commitments around integration, signage we mentioned earlier, that are now in that spec. So that was a huge opportunity. And I think, so on the franchise side, that's now embedded in the contract. I think when it comes to the infrastructure, I think there's obviously the sort of the high-level output specification around the five-year transport plan and some big projects within that. And then within those, we also have high-level specifications for things like Egypt, for borders, and the like. And I think there we set out the key high-level spec in terms of what we expect in terms of the outputs, and then it's for Network Rail to take that forward and engage locally on things like station improvements to ensure that that accessibility opportunity is fully realised. And I think where we see that things aren't, you know, as positive as we would like in that regard, I think we have got a track record of engaging with Network Rail, with ScotRail to ensure that that happens. So an example would be around Queen Street and cycle provision, for example, where, you know, we did make representations around what could be done to better improve cycling facilities within the Queen Street proposals and make sure that those conversations were happening with the cycling groups around all of that. And I think also just in terms of stakeholder engagement, hosting the regular stakeholder sessions, both on the Borders project on Egypt, too, we do quite a bit in terms of just encouraging that to happen.
The Transport Scotland specified and funds the Edinburgh Glasgow Improvement Programme, and you've already mentioned Queen Street. We've also had people talking about Haymarket and some of the problems there. Can you explain why consideration of the wider access issues appears not to have been an integral feature of these projects from the outset?
I think, I mean, ultimately we set a high-level specification. Things like the Egypt project, it's actually very high-level in terms of what we set. And I think, you know, there's a reflection there, which is inevitably it gets driven by some quantifiable elements within that. So expecting capacity of a percentage increase, you know, through the network, expecting 8-car train sets, for example, to run out of Queen Street, expecting journey time improvements between Edinburgh and Glasgow, Queen Street. We don't spell out in that all of the integration aspects within it. And I think part of that is because we expect, in a sense, that to be inherent within the station redesign. And actually, it's quite difficult to quantify that in a high level. So we want to preempt it and say, you know, the integration proposition is X, Y, and Z, because it inherently has to be something that is developed as part of that detailed design. And that means collaboration and working with the stakeholders locally to make sure that's done correctly. I think if it was to take a lesson out of this, if, you know, if we do need to spell that out in terms of just a very high-level reminder in terms of our transport objectives, and this is something that as funder we do remind on a high strategic level anyway, but if it needs to be spelled out in terms of that specification, what we'd expect in terms of improved accessibility, improved integration, albeit at a high level and not preempting what those valuable discussions need to come up with the stakeholders, then that's something I think we can take away and consider, you know, as part of that overall effort to improve the way that we work.
I noticed that the National Transport Strategy is to be refreshed. Will the experience that we've heard about from so many witnesses when it comes to transport integration, particularly at major railway stations. Is that likely to feature in any refresh of these guidelines?
Well, I don't want to preempt what the Minister will sign off at the end of the day, but I mean, it would be an obvious important source of evidence, the evidence that's been presented to the committee and the committee's final report itself. And integration, and the Minister's already on the record in terms of it's not about completely redefining our objectives, of which integration remains a key objective. So, it would be sensible in that context that everything that comes out of this committee would feed into that, and that access to major stations would be an important part. I think the other bit that the Minister already is on the record has been clear about is in terms of just clarity of roles of different organisations. We've already heard it's quite a busy field in terms of, in the rail side, Network Rail, ScotRail, and we've got some alignment there, but also the RTPs, local authorities, and just an opportunity to be clearer about the respective roles of those respective parties. I think, again, within the strategy, that's something the Minister's already spoken about.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Can I thank each of our witnesses for their evidence this morning, and can I particularly thank Mr. Verster for your openness and willingness to engage so constructively with this committee. We note your commitment to send us some information on the security advice and rationale for restricting access to Waverley Station. We look forward to receiving that. I wonder whether, for completeness, you might be able to send us some information, if you have it, on what the reduction has been the improvement that there has been in air quality since vehicles were required to leave Waverley Station.
We can do that, convener.
And also passenger numbers, the number of people who pass through Waverley on an annual basis. I think that would be helpful as well.
We'll do that.
Okay. We also note your offer to come before the committee again. You may yet live to regret that on a six-monthly or yearly basis, and we'll certainly take you up on that. We appreciate that offer very much. There are no further questions, so thank you for your evidence this morning. I will now allow a short pause to allow witnesses to leave the room. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, agenda item 5. The committee will consider a negative instrument, Property Factors Registration Scotland Amendment Regulations 2015, SSI 2015/217. Can I refer members to paper 7, which summarises the purpose and prior consideration of this instrument?
committee will now consider any issues that it wishes to raise in reporting to the Parliament on the instrument. Members should note that no motions to annul have been received in relation to the instrument, and I invite comments from members. There are no comments from members. In that case, is the committee agreed that it does not wish to make any recommendation in relation to the instrument?
Agreed.
Agreed. I now move this meeting into private.